We're live in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
So, good evening and welcome to this MOA Masterclass and preview to IOCON 2021. For further proceedings, I'll hand it over to our convener, Dr. Prakash Sigal. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Ashok. Good evening, everybody. At the outset, I welcome all of you on behalf of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association for this masterclass series of October 2021. This month, we are celebrating Osteoporosis Month, and the entire month, we have 5 webinars till today. This is the last webinar of the series, and today we are having a topic, Osteoporosis and Fractures of the Lower End Radius or Wrist Joint. Today, we have eminent faculties from Andhra Pradesh and from Maharashtra, and we are also having 3 interesting cases. From Andhra Pradesh, Dr. Abhishek Reddy, Dr. Ramanna, and we have speakers. And from Maharashtra, Dr. Vijay Kakatkar, sir, Dr. Rajesh Gandhi, and Dr. Abhijit Vayagaonkar will be presenting their work on fracture lower end radius. We have 3 cases also from Dr. Sudhir Warrier, sir, Dr. Pankaj Jindal, and Dr. Varid Alta. This time we have Andhra Pradesh as our partner for this program, and I welcome speakers from Andhra Pradesh and President and Secretary of Andhra Pradesh for this activity. Today our President is busy. Once he joins, we will ask him to talk. This is also a curtain raiser for IOCON 2021. So I will request Dr. Ram Chadda sir to give his presentation on the present preparations about IOCON 2021. Ram Chadda sir. Ram sir, are you there? Hello, can you listen me? Hello.
Yeah, it's audible, sir. It's audible.
Yeah, audible. So we'll start with the first presentation. Dr. Abhishek Reddy will talk on the overview of the osteoporotic fractures of the lower end radius of this joint. Over to Dr. Abhijit Reddy. He's from Andhra Pradesh, and we will start with first.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for the invitation from the Orthopedic Surgeon Society of Andhra Pradesh. So we are very much thankful to the MOA for making us partnering in this event. So I'll start my presentation. First of all, I would like to wish all the members a National Unity Day. So today being a Sardar Vallabhbhai Ji Jayanti, we are celebrating it as a National Unity Day. So stronger unions, Andhra Pradesh Ortho Association and MOA working together for a stronger union of fractures, very auspicious to start. Hope this day will be the best. So, are you able to see my screen, sir?
Yes.
Thank you. So, I'll start my presentation today. My part is the overview of osteoporosis and fracture lower end radius. So, osteoporosis is a progressive systematic skeletal disease characterized by low bone mass and microarchitectural deterioration of bone tissue, with consequent increase in bone fragility and susceptibility to fracture. The WHO defines osteoporosis as a T score less than minus 2.5 and osteopenia as T score minus 2.5 to minus 1. The types of osteoporosis by origin is primary as well as secondary. The primary osteoporosis is again classified as type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is postmenopausal. It is due to the estrogen withdrawal effect. And the type 2 is senile osteoporosis. And the secondary osteoporosis due to the underlying diseases like renal failure, hyperparathyroidism, long-term usage of corticosteroids and anticonvulsants, and tobacco and alcohol abuse. Primary osteoporosis affects 80% of women and 60% of men with osteoporosis. Type 1 osteoporosis mainly may occur in postmenopausal women, elderly women characterized by accelerated and disproportionate trabecular bone loss and associated with vertebral body and distal forearm fractures. Type 2 osteoporosis is involutional osteoporosis. It occurs in both men and women aged more than 70 years, characterized by both trabecular and cortical bone loss and associated with fractures of proximal humerus, tibia, femoral neck, and pelvis. The laboratory tests are the biochemical profile to evaluate renal and hepatic function, hyperparathyroidism, malnutrition, CBC, vitamin analysis, thyroid profile, and a bone densitometry, which is usually done by DEXA scan. So DEXA scan being costly and due to its non-availability, ultrasonic bone densitometry is an alternative. So the other laboratory tests which are advanced, which are used for use it in predicting the rate of bone loss or follow-up therapy response. So they are CTX1, which is a bone receptor marker, and N1NP is a bone formation marker. Their high turnover osteoporosis or low turnover osteoporosis is based on their levels at the interval. So if there is a high turnover osteoporosis, anti-resorptive therapy is the main treatment modality. And if there is a low normal turnover osteoporosis, it responds best to drugs that enhance bone formation. So pathophysiology of osteoporosis is mainly a balance between the bone formation and bone resorption. So showing the statistics, percentage of global population aged 60 or above from 1950 to 2015, it shows around 21% are above 60 aged individuals by 2050. And among them, 70% of people live in the developing countries, and one in six will be an Indian. So the geriatric population by 2050 is very high. The dimension of the problem, fracture incidence will increase 2 to 4-fold due to the aging of the population by 2050. In India, 6% are osteoporotic, and it amounts around 8 to 10 crores. Among them, 1/5 sustained fractures at least once in their lifetime. And it's a huge number. Unless these people are treated properly, it can cause an economic stagnation of a developing country like ours. Osteoporosis is treatable, but unfortunately, it is underdiagnosed, and we wake up when there is a fracture. And even after that, very little is done. Gerlach et al. Have found only 18% of the osteoporotic fracture patients treated were put on calcium or vitamin D or anti-resorptive drugs, and only 10% had previous treatment. The insufficient prophylaxis is a major concern preventing fracture. One fracture, osteoporotic fracture, leads to 2 to 5-fold risk of future fractures. 20% will have fractures on opposite side in 5 years of time. 26 to 47% risk reduction is achieved by anti-resorptive therapy. The rates of treatment for osteoporosis is very low. In India, Shetty et al. Found that 35% are put on calcium or vitamin D supplement, but only less than 1% are put on anti-resorptive drugs. In a study undertaken by Dr. Balu Sankaran, he reported osteoporosis to affect Indian population at an earlier age compared to Caucasians by almost a decade. All over the world now, fracture risk assessment is developed by WHO. It predicts fracture risks by bone mineral density and clinical risk factors. It provides individualized absolute risk over a 10-year period of hip fracture or a major osteoporotic fracture. These are the clinical risk factors in the fracture model. However, there are fallacies in these, which does not include the dietary calcium intake or vitamin D deficiency. But still, majority of the factors are included. The presence of each clinical risk factor increases probability of fracture incrementally. In most of the developing countries, fracture is yet to emerge. Bone mineral density, using dual energy X-ray absorptiometry, DEXA scan, is the standard golden method and indicator of fracture risk. However, due to its expensive and non-availability, in many of the centers, ultrasonic bone densitometry is an alternative. In India, we advise sunlight, which is abundant and bright with calcium and vitamin D, which are groundnut, soya beans, and sardine fish are good sources of it. They are easily available and affordable to all patients. And yoga exercises show, many reports show that it increases bone mineral density at a good level. The drug therapies include anti-receptives, bisphosphonates, selective estrogen receptor modulators, tamoxifen, calcitonin, teriparatide, denosumab, romosozumab, which is yet to come to India. And all these drug therapies are included with supportive calcium and vitamin D therapies. Of course, strontium renalate, which has not being used nowadays because of a high risk of thromboembolism. The other therapies are being used in a good amount. Tamoxifen is widely used by endocrinologists and gynecologists. The orthopedic treatment mainly lies with the bisphosphonates, calcitonin, parathormone, denosumab, and romosozumab yet to come. So FDA, these are all FDA-approved therapeutic drugs. The preventive drugs and treatment drugs, bisphosphonates include both. Estrogen is a preventive drug and the other drugs are therapeutic drugs. Teriparatide is a recombinant human parathyroid hormone, which is used for enhanced bone formation. It is being used as a 20 microgram subcutaneous injection OD into the thigh or abdominal wall. It costs around 3,000 to 4,000 per month. So it will come as a 1 month refill pack or 3 months refill pack based on different companies. It should not be used for more than 1.5 year to 2 years. So there are no long-term studies yet. Then anti-receptive drugs are bisphosphonates. The most common drugs used in India are alendronate, resipronate, and zoledronic acid injections. So these are very effective in treating osteoporosis. The complications of bisphosphonates are redness in the eye, spinal vertebral fractures, atypical femur fracture, osteonecrosis of jaw bones. Though all these complications have been reported, the benefit from these drugs far surpass the ill effects. So bisphosphonate therapy is the mainstay. Denosumab is a newer drug, human monoclonal antibody to Ranke ligands. It decreases bone resorption by inhibiting the formation and activity of osteoclasts. It should be given 60 mg subcutaneously every 6 months for about 2 to 3 years. The treatment of each dose costs around 1.2 lakh. Romosozumab is FDA approved in 2019, yet to come to India. It is widely marketed as SNET. This has a dual effect. It is a sclerostin inhibitor. It works as anti-osteoclastic and promoting enhanced bone growth. It acts at a dual level. So it is more effective than other modalities. It is administered as 2-10 mcg subcutaneously in the abdomen. So each dose costs $85. It is given as a monthly injection for a year. The surgical treatment goals for osteoporotic fractures is to operate as soon as possible to avoid complications, to prevent secondary fractures, to correct non-surgical problems, and to return to the same quality of life. We must understand that in osteoporosis and cancerous bones, there is a reduction in bone mineral density, trabecular thinned, and reduced in number. Thereby, the bone holding capacity of the implant is reduced. In cortical bone, as you see in the picture, there is continuous endosteal erosion more than the periosteal bone formation. And this results in cortex thinning out. So when a screw is fixed, instead of 4 to 5 threads, only 2 threads are engaged. Screws will become loose. So this was depicted by Pietro Regazzoni. So eggshell depiction. So this is a challenge in fixing osteoporotic bones. So the basic principle to be followed in osteoporotic bones to get good results in the present scenario is to use biological fixation, use of load sharing implants like interlock nails, tension band constructs, locking compression plates, bring about impaction and compression, which enhances stability, use of wide butter splints, use of tension band devices, long splintage, augmentation by bone cement or bone gaps. Finally, if you think there is no other option, replacement arthroplasty. No doubt, however, various anatomical plates which are shown in the pictures today have changed the scenario, again, especially in metaphyseal fractures. But basic mechanical and biological aspects in internal fixation of fractures can never be eclipsed by new fixation devices. Inferior surgical handicrafts is even more unforgiving in osteoporotic bone than in normal bone. A surgeon should be a gardener rather than a carpenter. Efforts have to be concentrated on prevention of osteoporosis and thereby fracture prevention, so that our elderly all over the world are saved from the agony of osteoporosis and related osteoporotic fractures. Coming to the distal and radius fractures, the distal and radius fractures are best described by John M. Agee as the radius fractures crush the mechanical foundation of man's most elegant tool, the hand. Hand being the most functional tool for a human being is most affected by distal radius fractures. So while talking about the distal and radius fractures, we should not forget Abraham Colles, who have described the Colles fracture in detail and described the reduction methods before the invention of X-ray itself. Then the rationale for precise management of distal radius fractures are: one of the most common skeletal injuries treated by an orthopedic surgeon, approximately representing 1/6 of all fractures. Risk factors include increasing age, decrease in bone mineral density, female sex, white race, family history, and early menopause, high potential for functional impairment, and frequent complications. Has a complication rate of 31% retrospectively. Common misconceptions regarding the management of distal radius fractures. We were always thinking and believing these. Now the time has come to revive these. Despite deformity, all these do well. So this was the acceptance at the past. But now with the advent of newer technology, newer inventions, the deformity is not accepted at all. Hand being a most flexible wrist, being a most flexible joint, having a good functional range, should not be affected with the deformity. You can always do a Dirac. So this was the perception. But Dirac will not give a 100% functional outcome. Arthritis is not a problem since it is not a weight-bearing joint. This is partly right for an elderly patient, but for a young challenging individual, this is not. This will not give a good functional outcome. External fixation will inevitably cause stiffness. This was the thinking. But external fixation, if not properly applied or over-distracted, will cause stiffness. If properly done with good principles, it gives the best results. Observe any median nerve compression as they will improve with time. This was thinking before. If you do that, you will definitely land in complications. If you see carpal tunnel syndrome, you have to decompress it at the earliest. There is no place for surgical treatment as the fragments are too small. This was thinking. But the newer invention of low profile rim plates, volar rim plates, dorsal rim plates, even the smallest fragments are being fixed and to it to their anatomical position for the best functional outcome. The bony anatomy distal radius shows three fossas, mainly scaphoid unit and sigmoid notch as shown. There are numerous classifications. You can follow anyone which guides you in the best treatment. X-rays and diagnosis will be dealt by the next speakers in detail. Not to assume all fractures are stable or will remain stable. Elias and Jupiter have described the unstable parameters very well. So we need to remember all these radiological unstable factors. So greater than 50% dorsal or volar comminution is very unstable. More than 20 degrees of dorsal tilt is not acceptable. More than 1 centimeter shortening, shearing, carpal fracture dislocation, and loss of opposition of more than 100%. Styloid base fractures and severe osteoporosis. These are all considered as unstable fractures. And unstable fractures, not to hold on all unstable fractures with unstable means. If you are using unstable methods, casts or K-wires, they are tend to fail. If fracture is unstable and the patient is not willing for surgery, always document and counsel that. CT scan are reserved for occult fractures and comminuted fractures. always do a CT after reduction, not to do CT scan without close reduction. See the difference. Left two photographs of X-ray shoe before reduction. And once you reduce, if they come into alignment, the picture of studying CT becomes very easy, as you see in the picture. So always try to do CT after close reduction. And MRI is helpful in carpal ligamentous disruptions and DFCC disruption, median nerve compressions, reflex impact with dystrophies, rupture of flexor or extensor tendons, and fracture of avian of carpal bones. Radionuclide scans are limited to reflex sympathetic dystrophies or in non-unions. And the treatment has progressed from reduction of deformity to anatomical reduction to achieve pre-injury function. They include close reduction immobilization, percutaneous pinning, external fixator, plate fixation, and newer modalities, arthroscopic assisted fixation, bridge splitting, and comminuted fractures. The era before X-rays, casting and splinting was done and explained by many practitioners: Edwin Smith Papyrus, Hippocrates, Foti, Abraham Collis. So this is Abraham Collis' treatise, who has described well the Collis fracture displacements and the method of fixation reduction. And Cotton has described the method of reduction in palmar flexion. This is Cotton Lauder position, which was earlier used. So this was causing carpal tunnel syndrome, compression of carpal. So slowly it has evolved into a dorsiflexion plaster, palmar flexion to dorsiflexion. Then in 1850, plaster of Paris was discovered, and it replaced glue, resin, and waxes. And in 1895, a major invention, Wilhelm Roentgen, discovered magnetic fields. So in 1896, FDA approved clinical usage of X-rays for Collis fractures in USA. So the first X-ray taken was for a Collis fracture. And a great tribute to John Chanley for his best description of treatment, a closer treatment of common fractures. Still the best reference for cast application in distal radius fractures. So how to reduce, how to apply a cast, three-point fixation. So when you are applying a close reduction cast, always take a weekly follow-up X-ray. So because they tend to be unstable, any fracture tend to be unstable or redisplacement. So it is at least required to take serial X-rays for 3 weeks. Because the redisplacement, when the redisplacement occurs, it is always safe to discuss with the patient about the necessity of surgery or the acceptance of complication. Then the NICE guidelines have given timing of surgery for distal radius fractures. So when a surgery is needed for distal radius, for intra-articular fractures, it should be done within 72 hours of injury. And for extra-articular fractures within 7 days of injury. And when a redisplacement of distal radius has occurred and when a decision of surgery has been taken, from the decision, the surgery is to be done within 72 hours. And the evidence so far is non-operative treatment recommended strongly for patients above 65 years with low demand. Cavers still have a large role to play. External fixator in selected cases only. Platelets with their design versatility can help in many patterns of fracture fixation. There are different kinds of plate which will be dealt in later topics. So the approaches, dorsal and volar, classic Henry's approach and extended carpal tunnel approach, and arthroscopic assisted intra-articular distal radius fracture fixation. There's an advancement, but it has a fallacy. If it is operated 5 to 7 days prior, so the vision or visibility of a joint is a major concern. So it has to be done between 5 to 15 days post-injury. And arthroscopy complements fluoroscopy, so which helps in identifying articular comminution, depressed or rotated fragments. The gap between the fragments, gap between the joints, ligamentous damage, all can be evaluated at its best. And reduction can be achieved with good fixation. So arthroscopic assisted intra-articular fixation is an option now for a tough intra-articular comminuted fractures. So the compartment syndrome and visibility immediately post-injury are the main concerns. The acute complications of distal and radius fractures are complex regional pain syndrome, acute carpal tunnel syndrome, associated carpal and tendon injuries, median or ulnar injuries, compartment syndrome, post-reduction swelling. Late complications are malunion, radial carpal arthrosis, stiff hand, shoulder hand syndrome, tendinous adhesions and plexar compartment, EPL rupture, carpal instability and non-union, really. So to conclude, in osteoporosis worldwide, more threat is a reality. It has to be faced with vigor and an interdisciplinary approach. Be innovative and use God-given sunlight, food supplements like groundnut, fish, milk, and yoga to prevent osteoporotic fractures. Antiresorptives are still the mainstay of medical therapy, but long-term therapy can cause complications, as already mentioned. Teriparatide, denosumab have opened new vistas for medical treatment of osteoporosis. Gene therapy and stem cell therapy are proving on new horizons and hope for osteoporosis. In distal radius fractures, do not forget these. Not to miss the unstable parameters, radiological parameters for a distal and radius fracture. And for unstable fractures, do not go with unstable fixations, cast or pins. Always see one joint above and one joint below. Radiocarpal joint above, so scapholunate joint, scaphoid, lunotriquetral joint, and one joint below, radioulnar joint, to be seen without any misdiagnosis. Non-operative treatment when performed, you should take weekly follow-up X-rays at least 3 weeks. And when there is a redisplacement, always counsel the patient and inform the necessity of surgery or acceptance of minor complications. When you are doing operative treatment, judicious usage of implants, variable implants, K-wires, X-fixed, whatever are combinations, you have to use the best. And intra-op radiology for projecting screws should not be forgotten. It will cause a devastating complications like tendon ruptures. And always make a habit of not forgetting to do piano key sign, elicit piano key sign for DRU gene stability for all the distal radius fracture fixations. Thank you for patient listening. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Yeah, thank you very much, Abhishek, for a lucid presentation on overview of osteoporotic lower end radius fractures. Now we have Dr. Ravindra Shinde has joined. He is a MMC observer for this master class. Welcome, Dr. Shinde, sir. Also, Dr. Ram Chadda is there. He has also rejoined. So I will request Dr. Ram Chadda, sir, to go ahead with the presentation on preparations for the IOCON 2021. Ram, sir. Hello. Yeah.
Good evening, friends. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear.
Good evening.
Good evening, friends. On behalf of the Maharashtra Orthopedic Association and the organizing team of IOCON 2021, it's my privilege to invite all of you first and foremost to this academic meeting today and acknowledge your presence. Secondly, extending my invitation on behalf of the entire team to each one of you from the states of Andhra Pradesh belonging to the OSAP, as well as the state of Maharashtra, and wherever all over the country and worldwide, this particular event is being telecast through a webinar to attend IOCON 2021 in Goa. It is my proud privilege to share with you where we have reached today in this tryst with uncertainty, where we've now got Goa lurking around the corner. We started on 15th of August this year, when we decided to take up the COVID challenge, leave the lethal elements out, and change from Mumbai to Goa. We began with our presidential theme of being Indian at heart, global in competence, hence practicing Atmanirbhar orthopedics. And I share with you the four important aspects of our conference. It is in Goa, the first time in 66 years that this conference is going to Goa, probably the most open part of our country today, as far as academic and non-academic activities are concerned, but with proper social distancing and COVID appropriate behavior. We are looking forward to each one of you being there at the Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Indoor Stadium and the various convention hotels from 21st to 25th of December this year, Tuesday to Saturday. I know most of you will come by air, a few may come by road. So I'm showing you what you would witness in person in that 1 week that you are there. Why did we move to Goa? Well, we got assurances from Goa. We were confident that Goa would open up in the month of December. Peak tourist season, had 80 lakh tourists last year, expecting 1.2 crore this year. Post-pandemic, each one of us needs to connect physically with each other. 22nd of September, we visited the Chief Minister of Goa, a healthcare worker like us, Dr. Pramod Sawant, and he welcomed us with open arms. Dr. B. Shiv Shankar, Dr. Naveen Thakkar, President and Honorary Secretary of the IOCA, Dr. Ajit Shinde, Organizing Chairman and President of the MOA, Dr. Shivanand Bandekar, Organizing Co-Chairman and Dean of GMC, Government Medical College, Goa. We were all there. We took all the permissions in place from the Sports Authority of India, as well as the university. And we took this area. This is an aerial view of the Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Indoor Stadium. This is what it looks like from the outside. It's a huge stadium, which can seat 4,000 people at a time. Our original plan was to have this whole area for our convention with the trade in the center and these five halls all around with certain break-off halls in between. This was with the idea of having 2,500 delegates. That was our vision, and we were thinking big because there was no such event which had happened for the past 18 to 19 months where so many people had attended. We got working, but lo and behold, we are now looking at 5,000 delegates. Why do I say that? And this Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Indoor Stadium by itself may be insufficient to maintain social distances and practice COVID appropriate behavior. Hence, we've now extended the footprint. This is the entire Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Indoor Stadium. This is the original area that we were looking at. We've now taken an adjoining area here and a huge cricket ground here. So our extended footprint is about twice the size of where we were originally. And we would have the academics, the non-academics, and a central area or a zone of registration. So we are now spread out and we are looking at 5,000 delegates coming in. 21st to 25th, Tuesday to Saturday. Tuesday, 21st, workshop and PG training. Dr. KT Dholakia, CME, based on current concepts in orthopedic techniques and technologies, being jointly done by the Orissa chapter along with the Maharashtra Orthopedic Association. Dr. Biswajit Sahu from there and the team from the MOA with Dr. Samprat Dumre Patil partaking in this event in a very, very positive and very, very academic manner. And of course, the main conference from Thursday to Saturday. We've taken all the permissions in place needed from the sports authorities and the vice chancellor of the Goa University. We are looking at a banquet on the beach Christmas Eve, 24th of December. We may look at a casino visit. We may also look at various other options for academic and non-academic fun and frolic. We have, as I said, workshops, PG teaching programs, the main conference, including the postgraduate quiz. Dr. Rajiv Raman from Kolkata is handling that. We've got more than 2,000 abstracts, which have actually been now finally shortlisted. We've got 14 gold medal sections. That's the entire grid of the program. I would briefly tell you what it is. 21st of December is the PG course and the workshops that we are looking at. Four of them have been planned right now. We may add a few. There is an inauguration and CME on the 22nd, which is Wednesday, followed by a welcome dinner. Thursday, 23rd are the gold medal papers, all the orations, which makes it totally 7 orations, 6 eponymous lectures and 6 guest lectures, plus the PG quiz. Friday, 24th, we have 3 of the gold medal sessions, which carry forward to the next day, the extraordinary general body meeting, the general body meeting and the banquet. And finally, on Saturday, we have special sessions and the valedictory. Having said that, all SOPs are in place. Government permissions have been taken. Travel restrictions will be there as of today. It is either an RT-PCR done 48 hours earlier before entering Goa or a final vaccination certificate. Most of us are healthcare workers and probably all of us do have vaccination final certificates more than 15 days old. That's where we are. International faculty is a challenge because of the Indo-overseas relationship as regards permission during the lockdown, etc. So we have to work out from country to country. Trade partners were reluctant in the beginning, but are now coming in large numbers. We have limited rooms available. Most of them are now getting sold out. We have about 11 hotels which are empaneled with us. And all of this is available both on the website as well as the brochures which would have reached you. I would like to thank Dr. Shiv Shankar and the entire Central Executive Committee and the COC, the CSRC and the EC. And this is the basic home team led by Professor Dr. Ajit Shinde, the organizing chairman and president, Dr. Shivanand Bandekar, who's the GMC Dean, Dr. Vasudev Gadegone and Parag Sancheti, and the entire workforce, each one of us who's been there and will be there. The academics is led by the 3 top academicians from Maharashtra, Professor Dr. G.S. Kulkarni, Professor Dr. Sudhir Babulkar, and Professor Dr. D.D. Tanna. They've planned an excellent program which begins at 8 in the morning and goes on till only 2 or 2:30. So the rest of the day is ours to do what we want in Goa. We broke the 2000 mark on 30th of September. Today, we are on the last day of October. We've released the physical brochure. And may I share with you that we stopped abstracts at 2166. We are trying to accommodate as many free papers and as many posters as possible. As of this morning, we are at 3,027 registrations. We have 773 registered for the CME. We have 1,225 registered for the banquet. I thank each one of you, those who have already registered, and I request those who have not, that this is a meeting where each one of us needs to interact physically beyond these screens that we have been looking at each other for prolonged periods of time. So please do come. Believe this is an important meeting after 2 years. And if you think it is important to you, I'm sure you'll find a way. If you think it's not, maybe you'll find an excuse. So I believe it is important. And I request you with folded hands to please be there in the month of December 21st to 25th at Goa. Anything that you need, this is the slide that you need to refer to. Please feel free to reach out to me. My team and I would be the happiest to look after you. Thank you very, very much for a patient hearing. Thank you to Dr. Durga Prasad, to Dr. Naresh Babu, and the entire team of the OSAP, all of whom are here, participating in a very, very partisan and a very, very happy manner, sharing their knowledge with us. And we are happy that you have come to share something about osteoporosis, beginning from 1895, when Wilhelm Conrad Roentgen accidentally found an X-ray of his wife in Würzburg, which we just heard, to romosozumab, as well as abaloparatide. So Dr. Abhishek has really, really educated us from one end to the other. And I'm sure there's much more to learn from each one of you. Thank you so much. Welcome to Goa.
Yeah, thank you very much, Ram sir. Now we have a second talk by Dr. Moparthi Srinivasa from Vijayawada, Andhra Pradesh. He will be talking on various classifications and physical examination of fracture lower end radius. Dr. Srinivasa.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Sujit. Just 1 minute. I am going to open this one.
Yeah. After this presentation, we will be having an interesting case by Dr. Sudhir Warrior, sir. So, after 2 presentations, we'll take an interesting case. So next will be Dr. Warrior, sir. interesting case.
Just one minute.
Yeah.
Is it opening?
Yes, yes.
You can see?
Still not complete.
Yeah, now?
Yeah. Just made it a presentation.
You can see, sir.
You make it a presentation mode. Just click on that icon where we are. Click there so that it will be in presentation mode.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. Go ahead.
First of all, I want to thank the Maharashtra Orthopedic Association, Dr. Ajit Shinde, Maharashtra Orthopedic Association Secretary Dr. Narayan Karne, and IOA Secretary Dr. Ram Chadha sir, and especially Prakash Sidekar. And OSAP President Dr. Durga Prasad sir, and OSAP Secretary Dr. Naresh Kumar, and the author TV Dr. Neeraj Bijlani and Ashok Shyam, and especially the IOA President Dr. Shivashankar sir. It's a privilege for us to give the opportunity to talk on the distal radius fractures classification. As we know, there is a lot of classification systems in the distal radius. As we see, there is a Pickman's classification is there. As if you see, there is a Fernandez classification is there, Barton's classification is there. So many classifications were came up with the OTA classification is there and AO classification is there. And recently, on the based on the intermediate column concept, the Ricci and Rigoni has brought to the newer classification system. So all these classification systems, sometimes it may be confusing. So I'll go with the simple AO OTA classification system, which is a concise and brief, which remembers us, which gives us very important points in our daily practice. What are the advantages of classification? It is main useful to, it helps in management of the impacting on the management of these fractures and to recognize how the fracture patterns are there. And what are the indications and treatment for this type of fractures, different injuries patterns. And we can, how to avoid the complications. So this fracture classification, when we see the x-rays, if you draw out a correct fracture line and this thing, we can opt for the treatment, which type of treatment we can give to which type of the fractures involved. Is the patient-centered, based on the age? If osteoporotic, if you see, or if it is old age people, if it is osteoporotic and the associated comorbidities, and based on the level of activities, the patient-centered, and next is the based on the mechanism of injury, it's a fragility versus high injury fractures. Next is the class-based fracture patterns, that is a specific criteria, and based on the radiological parameters. As we know, this distal radius column is the most important thing. That is, if you see, when we come to the anatomy, the dorsal cortex is thin and weak, whereas the volar cortex is thick and strong, big, based on the forces acting on the volar side. Whereas the dorsal side, there won't be any muscular attachments and insertions more of. It is, there will be, we can see the tunnels will be there. Different tunnels are transversing the tendons. And when we come to the cross section of the radius, this articulating surface, if you see, you can see the scaphoid facet and the lunate facet, whereas the sigmoid notch, where you can see the articulation of the radius and ulna joint, distal radial ulna. If you see fragment specific, it is a four column concept. That is, column two is, if you see, column one is the radial column, whereas the comes is the two is the intermediate column, whereas the third one is the ulnar column. And the other column two is the radial styloid. If you see the cross section, if you see the sagittal section, you can see the radial styloid, it is separate. Whereas the teardrop, we can see a teardrop on the volar side. Whereas on the dorsal side, that is a dorsal lunate facet column. So coming to the classification, I'll go briefly with the AO, this thing, which is a simplified. As you know, this two indicates the bone, that is in the upper extremity, whereas the R indicates the radius, whereas 3 indicates the distal area. Because if the radius is divided into, radius and ulna is divided into 1, 2, 3. The proximal metaphyseal region is divided as 1, whereas the diaphyseal region is divided as 2, whereas the distal epiphyseal region is divided as the 3. So it is indicates 2 or 3. For ulna, distal ulna is 2, U3. Classification. This AVO classification is only 3 concepts, that is extra-articular, partly extra-articular and partly intra-articular and intra-articular. So it is divided as A, B and C. The extra-articular is A. In this extra-articular fractures falls the, all these patterns like pollies or impacted fractures. That is that they are sometimes stable and sometimes unstable. If the fracture pattern is stable, then we can go with the non-operative management. If the fracture patterns is unstable, like if you see the wedging or comminution, this thing, then we have to go with the surgical operative management. Coming to the partly intra-articular, injury patterns are typically unstable. Very rarely we'll get a stable fractures in the partly intra-articular. Most of them will be the volar button or dorsal button. In this, the surgical is indicated in this type of fractures. Coming to the C, it is more of a intra-articular. Intra-articular associated with the severe comminution, with the disruption of the joint, or intra-articular with metaphyseal comminution. It can be a T-type or U-type. Here you can see is the U-type. This is the U-type, whereas here you can see is the T-type. T-type pattern. Here. You can see the T-type pattern. The extra-articular, again, it is divided into A, B, and C. Extra-articular is the coming to the radius distal segment fracture. It can be a simple distal segment. That whereas 3B is partly articular, as I told you, this is intra-articular. Extra-articular is subdivided into A1. A1 can be a styloid, chip avulsion. Whereas coming to A2-1, that is a simple extra-articular metaphyseal fracture. This is a stable pattern. Now we can go with the non-operative management, whereas displacement will be there. That is a dorsal displacement till the colis. This is called as colis. Well, as a volar displacement, it is called as Smith's fracture. So it is subdivided into A2-1, A2-2, A2-3. Extra-articular. A indicates the extra-articular. Next comes is the extra-articular with subgroups A3, A31, A3. This is A3. That is A2. A3 is again further divided into intact wedge fracture. You can see a single segment of wedge, whereas fragmentary wedge, that is A3-2. You can see the multiple wedges, like comminution. Whereas multi-fragmented fracture, that is A3-3, it causes the multiple comminution. So coming to the next pattern is the injury pattern is typically unstable, that is partly intra-articular. These are further subdivided. Here you can see. Here there will be divided into B. This categorized as B. That is a B1 that is involving scaphoid fossa, whereas B1-3 is involving the lunate fossa. Again, this is a subgroup, that is B2, that is a simple fracture, where you can see it's just a comminution is there, simple involvement of the intra-articular zone is there, whereas further this one goes into fragmentary component, either it's a dorsal rim, it can be buttons, or it can be a dorsal button, it can be, if it is reverse, that is a reverse button, that is a Smith's. There will be associated disruption of the carpal dislocation will be there. If you see here, this is the reverse of the button. Here it is the volar component. In this is the dorsal rim, that is the dorsal button. Here the dorsal rim is involved and there is an intra-articular involvement. So there will be disruption of the carpal complex, proximal row complex. Whereas coming to the B3-1, this thing, and B3-3, it comes as the Vola. This is Vola. That is reverse button. That is Smith's. These are fracture patterns. Here you can see the disruption, dorsal button. And coming to the classification of the intra-articular, that is the C. Here you can see is the involvement of the fossas will be there. It can be a T-type, or it can be U-type, or it can be a associated more metaphyseal comminution. Here you can see there will be dorsomedial articular fracture. You can see this is completely articular and metaphyseal, simple metaphyseal. Here you can see it's a T-type, is a sagittal articular, you can see. But in this type of fractures, you can see there will be a stability of the distal radial nerve joint. Distal radial nerve joint, that is a sigmoid notch, which is important thing in successful outcome in the wrist pronation and supination. So they, in this sagittal articular fracture, where there is no involvement of the sigmoid notch, you can, the results will be good if you fix properly. Whereas coming to the frontal coronal articular fracture, like in this type of fractures, the results, if you not fix it, means the results won't, they won't be a good results, because there will be involvement of the distal radial joint, that is the sigmoid notch. So the patient will have a painful supination, pronation, and wrist flexion and extension. Coming to the comminution of the metaphyseal, you can see associated, simple associated intra-articular with metaphyseal comminution. Whereas a frontal comminution, you can see there is a frontal split, this is a sagittal split, and this one extending into diaphysis. This is U-type pattern, this is basically. This is a sagittal articular, is a semi-T-type pattern. You can see there is a, it's further subdivided, metaphyseal, this thing. Here, that is a simple metaphyseal is will be there, but there will be both coronal and sagittal will be there. Whereas metaphyseal will be multifragmentary with associated intra-articular component. Associated, this is a sagittal, coronal, and axial. Whereas this is extending into the diaphysis is a multifragmentary. This is complex. The results sometimes will be disastrous. Coming to the ulna, the again is ulna is, if you take the ulna, there will be associated styloid tip fractures. There will be avulsion of the TFCC complex when it is associated with the ulna styloid process, and distal radial ulna joint, the results will be somewhat disastrous. Again, this ulna, the ulna coming to the ulna, tip of the styloid fracture will be there, and base of the styloid fracture will be there. Here, the TFCC is involved in this component. Whereas again, it's a subgroup, it is divided. You can see here, you can see the oblique type fracture, oblique spiral fracture, whereas oblique fracture more than 30 degrees angulation, whereas transverse fracture less than 30 degrees angulation. These oblique and this transverse, the results will be good sometimes. Whereas the coming to the spiral, there will be strong force of the TFCC, sometimes rotation will be more. So we have to be careful when dealing with the spiral fractures and the base of the styloid fractures, base of the styloid and the tip of the styloid. Because what happens is there will be strong TFCC force. These are the associated fractures. Coming to the physical examination, when these fractures, there will be deformity. Most of the time, median nerve won't get injured, but sometimes you can see the median nerve is involved. And there will be associated in the distal radial fractures. You can see the styloid, intra-articular, extra-articular. Distal radial ulnar joint is involved. And the radiocarpal dislocation, you can see in the buttons, volar button or the dorsal button. And imaging is a simple fractures. No, normal routine X-rays, AP, lateral oblique view is enough. If it is a comminution is there, is better is to get the CT scan with the 3D reconstruction films, so that we can see the facets of the sigmoid, scaphoid, and lunate fossas. Goals of treatment, it is to maximize the patient outcomes, focus on patient-specific treatment, what is his functions, what are the functional activities, and what is the age of the patient. His most important thing is to achieve a pain-free and functional wrist, and to reduce the complication of management, So for that thing, we have to make appropriate implant choice, and we precise surgical execution interoperable to fix the fracture. Also, if it is a combination, sometimes you can go with the KYS, external fixators, and ligamentotaxis, which gives a good successful outcome. And the most thing is in geriatric patients is associated, as Abhishek has told, we have to go with the parathormone supplements. Next is the bone supplements, calcium, vitamin C, and vitamin D. And early motion is the most important thing in order to reduce the complications like complex regional pain syndromes. So better to, when we are doing the X-ray after fixation, better to get a perfect view. Otherwise, the screws will be in the joint. So this is the method. You can see this is the correct lateral view. We can see whether the screw is correctly in the into the subchondral zone or it is into the articular zone. Take home a message, identify the key factors impacting on the management, recognize how injury patterns are indications for treatment, and make a decision to avoid complications, how to proceed. Nowadays, the newer concepts are coming up with the intermediate column fractures that by Ricky and Rizzolini, that are coming up with their published in journals, open access journals in 2018, exclusively for the sigmoid notch, because the results of fractures of the sigmoid notch are becoming devastating in the functional outcomes of the wrist, because that the sigmoid notch is the most area where the distal radial notch joint is involved. So supination, pronation, and the functional outcome of the wrist, like flexion and extension, the volar tilt or dorsal tilt, whenever they do the movements, the patient is going to have a pain. So the newer column concept of intermediate column fracture concept is coming up now slowly to, in order to maintain the distal radial nerve joint in distal radius fractures. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Srinivas. Classification is very important in treating the fracture lower end radius, as you know, because once we know the morphology and different types of fractures, we can plan accordingly the treatment. And outcome, functional outcome also depends on classifying and treating it in a proper way. Thank you very much. Now we'll be having one case by Dr. Sudhir Warrier, sir. Interesting case presentation. Dr. Sudhir Warrier is a very well-known hand surgeon from Mumbai. I request sir to share his case.
Srinivas, if you can stop sharing.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sigedar, for this wonderful opportunity. In the curtain raiser towards the IOA con, and I have a very simple message about fractures with osteoporosis in patients who have osteoporosis and associated other ailments and severe fractures like this one. So here's a patient who's got a very, very difficult fracture. When you look at this, you know straight away that this cannot be treated conservatively. This cannot be treated by KYS. This may not yield itself to external fixators, and therefore you need to think a little more. So what are your options in these cases, and what are your challenges in these cases? Well, this is a 58-year-old housewife, very active, and she's been having rheumatoid arthritis for 18 years. She's on steroids and on methotrexate, and she's a diabetic. So that just makes the whole problem a little more compounded. But what we did was we fixed the distal radius with a volar locking plate, as was averred to by the first speaker. And that looked quite good, and it was fairly stable once we got it. Though, if you look at the displacement, everything is on the dorsal side. But what you need to look up is to see whether there is enough of the volar side fragment where you can get a hold with your screws. Because on the dorsal side, you would be left with, as the previous speaker mentioned, very thin, very soft bone, especially with osteoporosis. So once we fix that, we also fix the ulnar side by folding that out with a good plate and got this the distal radio ulnar joint and the sigmoid notch well back into position and restored most of the alignment problems of this fracture. She went on to heal over a long period of time, and if you notice the x-ray of the carpus, you will realize that she does have a problem because she is on steroids, she is a rheumatoid patient, she is also suffering from diabetes. But eventually, she did have an excellent result when you take into account the problem that she had come with. The fracture was a very, very severe fracture, and this is a fragility fracture. Now, what is a fragility fracture? Fragility fracture is one which you sustain from a simple fall, not from a standing height, not from anything higher or with the higher velocities. So it's a very simple fracture. I mean, it's a very simple modality of injury. What was different for this patient was the post-op care. We had to support this soft bone for 3 weeks in a plaster slab and then in a removable splint for a further 6 weeks. We then had active mobilization of the wrist from the third week post-op when the plaster slab came out and continuous physiotherapy for 6 months. That's the most difficult period because the patient has swelling, the fingers don't flex fully, they tend to go into an RSD, they have shoulder problems, and that is something that you have to be actively involved much more than just doing that surgery. Don't forget, she is a rheumatoid patient. Some of them do have a lot of other problems, and this is her final function, which shows that the complete flexion of the fingers is still not there. Now, this may have been pre-existing, and if you need to look at the other hand to know whether this was pre-existing or not. What are the special tips for such fractures anywhere else in the for any fracture in the body for these patients? Number one, when they're on methotrexate, should you stop methotrexate? Well, it's not necessary to stop methotrexate. It does not affect bone healing. Should you, the patient is on oral steroids, as was my patient. Now, should you ask them to stop the steroids? In fact, you must convert them to IV steroids and you must try and give them hydrocortisone 50 milligrams TDS IV so that the other joints don't flare up. This patient does not have rheumatoid arthritis limited to only the hands. The other joints can flare up. So you must continue that. That's very important. What about other supportive treatment? You must give teriparatide, and it is extremely useful in this phase. You must plan at least a 5 to 6 month course of daily subcutaneous injections of almost 8 units daily. It's a low dose, but it's good to keep the fracture healing well, and it prevents other fractures and allows a quicker recovery. The cost is a problem. It will be approximately 15,000 rupees a month, but there are Indian brands which are a little cheaper and will probably be a good solution. What about calcium? Well, we need to give the patient calcium, but we need to up the doses. The normal doses are not good enough, so you must give calcium 500 milligrams 3 times a day, and that will help the patient. And just quickly, I'm going to show you another patient who's 72 years old, sedentary and independent, and refused an open procedure. Identical old man, fragility fracture, and I used an external fixator. I used a bridging external fixator. The ulnar injury was not tackled. I thought it's not going to be too much of a problem. So I regarded this as an automatic Darax procedure. What do you think would be the outcome? Horrible, extremely stupid outcome, because this is not what I set out to get. The distal radius completely shifted. Now, why was this? Because as usual, I removed the fixator at 4 weeks or 5 weeks. That's not good enough. These fractures tend to settle even beyond 5 and 6 weeks. You may have to hold on the fixator for a longer time. But however, the patient was extremely happy with his result. The ulnar did not give him too much trouble. But if you look, there is some discomfort when he's doing his supination, but he's still happy and he's still independent. So you need to be very careful when you're dealing with distal radius fractures of this variety. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for this interesting case. Any comments or suggestion from the faculties or anything? Because we are taking cases in between to make it an interesting and interactive discussion. Otherwise, only theoretical discussions will be more lazy.
Sir, what is your indication for CT scan in such patients?
If you've seen enough distal radius fractures and if you've seen enough CT scans, you've already made a mental note when you can look at an X-ray and know what's happening. It is good to convince the patient that he needs an operation because the CT scan just shows all the fragments completely spread all over, and that is a good thing to show the patient. A 3D CT scan will scare anybody. But realistically speaking, I don't ask for a CT scan except in very few patients, especially the ones where I have impacted fractures, when I have lunate die punch fragments or scaphoid die punch fragments or a central depression. Most of those fractures, I would ask for a CT scan, but on a routine basis, it's not really essential.
Yeah. Thank you.
Good evening, Dr. Warrior, sir. Dr. Abhijit here.
Yes, sir.
So what is the implant of your implant of choice for a distal and ulna fractures with a good bone quality and with a poor bone quality?
Whatever I can lay my hands on, there are ulnar hook plates. There's the plate that I used in this case. There's the distal radial styloid plate. We can use that. I sometimes use a 2.0 plate with a T configuration, which has two screws at the distal end. That comes from the 2.0 system from certain companies. Whatever you use, the idea is to have at least one good strong hold with a 2.4 screw in the head and at least two or three screws proximally to hold this out. When you're using it for the ulnar styloid fractures type 1 or 2, you might just use tension band wires also.
Thank you very much, sir. Now we'll move on to the, if there are any more questions, we'll move on to the third talk. Diagnosis and role of newer modalities in diagnosis and treatment of lower end radius fracture with osteoporosis. Dr. Ramanna SSV is from Guntur, Andhra Pradesh, and he will be talking on diagnosis and role of newer modalities in the diagnosis and treatment. Yeah, Ramanna.
So, good evening, all. I am Dr. SSV Ramana from Guntur.
Just make it a presentation mode, sir. Presentation.
Yeah. So, I'm very glad to see Sudhir Warrior sir here and after a long time. So, this is my topic is osteoporosis and the distal radius fractures management. Latest modalities. So as you pretty well know, this BMD indicates only the osteoporosis, but it will not give the clue regarding the management, and it will not be useful for for stopping the risk of falling or bone fragility. So that is why we often depend on the clinical features and the age of the patient and the gender of the patient. So laboratory data, it has got very limited value in diagnosis of osteoporosis. Bone markers like pilopeptide is only to monitor the effect of the treatment rather than the diagnosis. And also it will be helpful to exclude the secondary causes of osteoporosis like hyperthyroidism, hyperparathyroidism, and deficiencies like estrogen, testosterone, multiple myeloma and cancer.
Sir, sorry to interrupt here. Make it a presentation mode so that it is visualized better and it is very easy for you also to move the slides. There is one icon here. So just click on that. So it will be a slide presentation mode. By that, that is not. So, 100%, just by the side of 100%, there is one icon. Yeah, just click on that. Now it's good. So it is visible better also, and you can move the slides. Yes.
So methods to evaluate the osteoporosis: quantitative ultrasonography, quantitative computed tomography, DEXA, dual energy X-ray absorptionmetry. But it depends on the measurement depends on the site of the measurement. Heel and forearm, easy to access, but outcome of fracture of vertebra and hip are very defective in this. Hip site, best correlation with the future hip fracture. Vertebra are the spine, risk of falsely assuming the scores of underlying if there is osteophyte or osteoarthritis. So BMD, as all of us know, it is T-score, which is the standard deviation of the BMD from average sex match 35 year old. Z-score, it is less used, but the standard deviation score compared to age-matched controls. According to the WHO osteoporosis T-score, if it is less than minus 2.5, osteopenia T-score -1 to -2.5. For every 1 decrease in T-score, double risk of the fracture. And regardless of this, BMD patients with prior osteoporotic fractures have up to 5 times risk of fracture in the future. So magnetic, this is a radiographic evaluation. PA view, lateral wind, oblique view, commonly we take for these fractures of the distal radius. And sometimes we need to assess the contralateral distal also to evaluate the deformity. Computed tomography, planes with 2 millimeters contiguous sections. It's useful to evaluate the complex or occult fractures, distal radial articular surfaces, distal radio ulnar joint, ventromedial fracture fragment, and assessment of the fracture healing, and also the post-surgical evaluation. So MRI, it is not the first choice in evaluating the acute radius fracture, distal radius fractures, but it is a powerful diagnostic tool to assess the bony, ligamentous, and the soft tissue abnormalities associated with these distal radius fractures. For delineating the perforation of the triangular fibrocartilage complex, it is very much useful. For perforation of the interosseous ligaments also, it is very useful. For evaluating the occult fractures and post-traumatic or avascular necrosis of the carpal bones associated, can also be delineated by the MRI. So these are the various tilts. Radial inclination of up to 22 degrees, radial shortening, and volar tilt up to 11 degrees. This is the normal anatomical. So here we can see the height of the radius, which will be reduced in the distal radius fractures, which we need to maintain the length of the radius while we treat these distal radius fractures, very important aspect of the treatment. Modes of treatment, casting either long arm or short arm POP cast, depending on the patient's age and gender and also the activity, level of activity of the patient. External fixators, either joint spanning or non-bridging, percutaneous K-wire pinning, internal fixations, either dorsal plating or the volar plating. Usually we use the locking compression plates. Sometimes you can as well do the combined dorsal and volar plating. And sometimes you can as well do the focal plating. This is the algorithm for the distal radius fractures. Undisplaced we can as well, and also the old people more than 65 years and less active people, you can as well go out with the cast or splinting. And displaced, if they are reducible, it depends on the treatment, depends on the whether they are reducible or irreducible. And if they are reducible, is it an extra-articular fracture or intra-articular fracture? And we just try to do the closure reduction. If it is stable, again, we'll put a cast. If it is unstable, we go for either percutaneous pinning or external fixator with bone grafting if the combination is more. Or sometimes you can as well go out with the plating, usually the volar plating. And the irreducible or unstable varieties, in the extra-articular, we go out with the external fixator with the bone grafting, depending on the combination, or sometimes with the plate. There is intra-articular component. If it is partial, we go out with the open reduction interfixations. Sometimes we can as well fix with the K-wires first to reduce the fractures, small components, and followed by the plate or tension band. In complete fractures, sectional fixator, or sometimes limited ORF with bone grafting and K-wires, or plate and bone grafting. So this is the algorithm which we follow for the distal radius fractures. And our goal of treatment is preserve the hand and wrist function, realign the normal osseous anatomy, especially the articular surface. Articular fragments have to be reduced in a nice way to prevent the secondary osteoarthritis or the pain, promote bony healing, allow early finger and elbow range of movements. So indications for closer treatment are low energy fracture, already I told you, low demand patients and medical, having the medical comorbidities and minimal displacement with acceptable alignment, we can go out with the simple closure reduction and cast application. Closure treatment. So to obtain and maintain an acceptable reduction, immobilization in long arm cast for high demand patients or short arm cast for elderly patients with low demand. Frequent follow-up is necessary in order to diagnose redisplacement. Every week up to first 3 weeks, we need to take the chest X-ray to see the fracture getting displaced in the cast itself. So radiographic criteria for acceptable healing of a distal radius fracture. Radioulnar length shortening should be less than 5 millimeters. And radial inclination should be more than 15 degrees. Radial tilt should be between 15 to 20 degrees. Articular incongruity should be less than 2 millimeters. This is the important criteria, radiological criteria. So technique of close reduction under anesthesia to relieve the pain and to decrease the muscle spasm. Hematoma block also can be given, intravenous sedation or Byers block. Traction, finger traps or weights. Reduction maneuver, hyperextension of the dorsal fragment, the distal fragment, correct the radial tilt, maintain the traction and reduce the distal to the proximal with pressure applied to the distal radius. So apply a well-molded splint or cast with the wrist in neutral to slight flexion. So we'll take a check X-ray to confirm the reduction. Prediction of instability, age more than 80 years. Initial displacement of fracture, extent of metaphyseal comminution, displacement following closure reduction. indications for surgical management, high energy injury with the instability, comminuted displaced intraarticular fractures, open injury, radial inclination less than 15 degrees, articular step off or gap of more than 2 millimeters, dorsal tilt more than 10 degrees, distal radioulnar joint incongruity. So operative management. So type 1, mostly we go out with the non-operative. Only few by external fixator. Type 2 is ORF with buttress plate. And type 3 fixation with multiple K wires and plates with cancellous bone grafting. Type 4, secure reduction of carpus to distal radius by K wires. Type 5, combination of percutaneous pinning and external fixation. Percutaneous pinning. So a single beam placed through the radial styloid process as suggested by Lamberte. Deepama introduced the concept of large pin, ulnar radial pin fixation for the fractures of distal end of radius with articular surface involvement. Kapanji, double intrafocal pinning and triple intrafocal pinning by using the 2 millimeter pins directly into fracture surface and then to proximal fragment provides a dorsal buttress for a distal fragment. This is very important while do the 5K wire pinning also. This placement of the pins through the fracture site into the proximal fragment, which will provide a dorsal buttress for the dorsal fragment, distal fragment. Another method of ulnar radial pinning with fixation of distal radial ulnar joint. That is, this is K-wire, percutaneous K-wire fixation. So in the 5K-wire technique, 5K-wire fixation we are doing nowadays in our general hospital also, which is using the proximal and distal ulnar radial pins, distal and proximally, to prevent the rotations.
Sir. Sorry to interrupt here. Time is exceeding and this topic is already being covered, is going to be covered by other speakers.
Okay.
So, please.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Please conclude.
This is the plate fixation, yeah. Arthroscopic assisted fracture reduction. Yeah. So distal radius fracture is one of the most common fractures in osteoporotic patients. Low energy extraarticular fracture, best to manage it conservatively. Wrist arthroscopy holds a promising future for this fracture. Thank you. Thank you all
for patience. Thank you very much, sir. And sorry to interrupt here. So next talk will be by Dr. Kakatkar, sir, on close plaster cast and close pinning for the fracture lower end radius with osteoporosis. Dr. Kakatkar, sir, is a senior most orthopedic surgeon practicing at Nashik. He was a past president of MOA and he has a vast experience in treating the trauma, especially fracture lower end radius. So I request Dr. Kakatkar, sir, to start with his presentation.
Can you see my screen?
No, sir. Start sharing. So after Kakatkar sir's presentation, there will be one interesting case by Dr. Pankaj Jindal. Yeah. I request all the speakers to please keep your time. Already we are overshooting the time and stick up to your topic of presentation.
Is it visible now?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Dr. Sigedar and the organizing team of the IOICON. I think we have chosen a very important and common topic for the today's webinar, that is distal end radius fractures in osteoporotic bones. And I am going to talk to you about the K-wire and close reduction fixation of these fractures. There has been a significant evolution since Abraham Colles described this fracture in 1814, which was a primarily an extra-articular fracture having six components like dorsal displacement and dorsal tilt, radial displacement, radial tilt, impaction, and supination of the fragment. But the scenario has changed a lot in the last couple of years, and in our day-to-day practice, we see variety of patterns of the fractures of lower end radius than only an extra-articular one. As it has been already said, it's one of the commonest fracture, and 16% of our injuries, we see this fracture. It has got a bimodal distribution. Young patients having extra-articular fractures, mainly pediatric patients, young adults having high energy injuries, and today's interest is about the osteoporotic fractures in elderly. It has been already stressed upon different views, and I would just stress again once more about two views. One is the lateral view, which should be taken in about 10 to 15 degrees of flexion, and you can very clearly see that if you take it in 10 to 15 degrees of flexion, the visualization of the articular surface is very nice. There is another view called as a traction view, which gives you idea about how you can plan your strategy of treatment in addition to the other modalities like CT scan. To give an example, you know, the left side picture shows you the first X-ray wherein you can see the fracture which is dorsally tilted and dorsally displaced and radially tilted and displaced. And just on X-ray table without any anesthesia, you just give traction and it shows you the reducibility of the fracture. And you can see that there is a big gap over here where the bone has collapsed. So it gives you about idea about how you are going to plan your strategy of treatment. Another example, you can see an impaction into this with a dorsal tilt and displacement, and you just give gentle traction on the X-ray table without anesthesia, and you can see how nicely you can reduce, and even though it looks impacted over here, you know that there is no collapse of the cancellous bone and you don't need any bone substitute or grafts when you are planning for the further treatment. It has been already mentioned by the other speakers about the acceptable criteria for the reduction. So I won't talk about it. The predictors of stability of this particular lower end radius fracture are associated ulnar styloid fracture, age of the patient, the mode of injury like shearing or avulsion or high velocity injuries can result into an unstable injury. Extent of metaphyseal comminution again decides about the unstable injury. As I have shown in the traction view, the first case that I have shown, this is an unstable fracture because there is a lot of comminution and collapse of the cancellous bone. And the last criteria is if you have done a close reduction and if there is a redisplacement, you know that this fracture is not going to remain stable without doing something further. The treatment options, as have been already mentioned, is cast, percutaneous pins, X-fix, arthroscopic assisted plate and SOS bone graft and fragment specific. And my today's talk is about percutaneous pins. The treatment decision depends on three important factors, that is reducibility, and after you reduced, how stable it is. And the third important part is whether there is any articular involvement. The algorithm, again, it has been already talked by the previous speaker, but I'd like to elaborate a bit on that. The non-articular fractures, if they are undisplaced, straight away go for plaster cast. The displaced ones we will see in the next slide. The articular ones undisplaced, again, go for K-wire or cast. And we see about the displaced ones in the next slide. The non-articular displaced ones, if they are reducible and stable, then go for cast immobilization. Reducible but unstable, then they go for percutaneous pins and a plaster. And irreducible fractures go for open reduction fixation or X-fix. And articular displaced fractures, if they are reducible and stable, they go for K-wire. Reducible, unstable fractures go for either arthroscopic assisted plus K-wire or X-fix. Irreducible, obviously, go for open reduction and plate fixation plus sometimes additional augmentation with K-wires or X-fix. And the complex ones go for either open reduction with bone graft or X-fix with K-wires. there are certain important tips and pearls. If you encounter dorsal comminution with intra-articular extension, one should consider augmenting with an external fixator. If there is a palmar cortex instability, then you should not think about percutaneous pinning. Go for a volar plate. And if the close reduction is not achievable, consider limited open reduction and K-wire fixation. The advantages of close reduction and K-wire fixation are it's a less invasive procedure, short surgical time, it's safer in elderly with comorbidities, can be very easily done under regional anesthesia like brachial block or scalene block. Short hospital stay, the patient can go home either on the same day or the next day, and obviously less financial burden. There are high chances of collapse in osteoporotic bones fixed with only K-wires. So with the advent of good quality and low profile locking plates, both on volar as well as on the dorsal side, sometimes plating is a preferred modality in osteoporotic bone. I think all of us being trauma surgeons, we know about the technique of close reduction, which was originally described. The constructs of K-wires can be of varied type. And this is a slide which gives you idea that you can put two parallel K-wires through the radial styloid. You can pass two cross K-wires. You can pass this through the lesion Kapanji's technique, or you can pass a K-wire which will do the fixation of radius with ulna to get stability without involving the radioulnar joint. Or you can have a wire passing through the radioulnar joint, which will prevent any collapse. Or the last one is you can have multiple K-wires. You know, so the K-wire can be used in different ways for giving stability to the lower end radius fracture. And as it has been very elaborately described by Breaks in the principles and techniques of K-wiring, you know, how you should pass the K-wires, how you should first pass a K-wire from the Lister's tubercle, then from the radial styloid, and then if required, the third wire through the inferior radial nerve joint. So these are the, I think all of us, we have been doing K-wires for a long time. And one of the problems that one can face occasionally is that the wire starts going intramedullary and it doesn't give proper stability. So in those situations, I think you should withdraw the wire, change the angle after withdrawing it almost to the entry point, and then pass it in a proper angle so as to engage the proximal cortex. And once you reach the proximal fragment cortex, do not use the vertical pressure. Just increase the speed of a drill so that it can pierce the cortex rather than slipping onto the cortex. And try to keep the wires little sharp so that they do not migrate into the medullary canal, but they can go through the cortex very easily. But it is very important to achieve bicortical purchase for every K-wire so that it can give proper stability. In severely comminuted osteoporotic fractures, Kapanji's technique of multiple intrafocal K-wires through the fracture site only gives a dorsal splintage to the distal fragment. And in severe porotic bones, in spite of these multiple K-wires passing through the fracture site, it really cannot prevent the collapse and shortening. In severe osteoporosis, 4 to 5 wires to transfix the fracture can be used. In osteoporosis, transfix the radius fragments with distal ulna with transverse K wires. And many a times, instead of a below elbow, you can give a above elbow cast to prevent the supination pronation. I'll share with you some cases. This is a 62-year female. You can see that fracture showed a complete collapse and disruption of the distal radioulnar joint with a dorsal displacement. And this was the post-op picture. Because there was a complete disruption of the radioulnar joint, So a transverse wire to get stability of the radioulnar joint is very important. And two cross K wires, one from the radial styloid and one from the listous tubercle area. And you can get a good stability. And this is at the end of 2 months. So I have removed the other wires. Only the radial styloid wire is maintained. And after another 2 weeks, we have removed this wire so that you can maintain the reduction very well and you can get a best outcome. Another 62-year female with a dorsal displacement, you can see a broken bangle as a foreign body with a small punctured wound. So that was also removed. And this particular intra-articular extension was there for this fracture. And there was a collapse. So this was fixed with, again, 3K wires, one from styloid, one from the listers, and the radioulnar joint. And it gave a good result. Another 61-year male.
Hello.
This was volar displaced fracture with a collapse. Mm. And you can see again the K wires passed and somebody's mic is on. Can you mute yourself? Yeah, and this is at the end of 6 years. The patient came for something else, so we just got his picture at the end of 6 years, and it was maintaining the position very well. And this is his function, almost 100% movements at the end of the 6 years. This is another 56 years male. This was a volar Barton fracture. Normally, one would prefer putting a volar plate in this kind of a coronally split fracture with a volar displacement of the entire radiocarpal joint. But in some of these cases, if the quality of bone is not too bad, you can opt for this technique, that in addition to getting reduction in a completely supinated position, you can pass a radial styloid wire, the radioulnar wire, and one wire from dorsal to ventral, because the dorsal cortex is intact in these patients. So you take advantage of that, and you can't pass a wire from the volar side because of the neurovascular structures. So you can pass a wire from dorsal to ventral side and immobilize it in an above elbowplaster. And I have been using this technique for number of patients where the bone quality is not too bad and they give excellent results. This is a long-term follow-up of this patient and has got excellent result. Another one, 66 years male with an intra-articular extension and ulnar styloid fracture. And we have stabilized with three wires and we have put a K wire for the ulnar styloid also and had an excellent outcome. You can see the function at the end of 2 months. Another volar displaced fracture, again, volar Barton kind of an injury. And here again, I have used a dorsal to ventral wire in addition to the radial styloid and radioulnar wire. And you can see the function at the end of 3 months. Another intra-articular comminuted fracture, you can see a displaced or impacted scaphoid, the fragment of the articular surface and a very small piece of bone on the dorsal side, which is almost like a rim injury, rim fracture. I have used a K wire to elevate this fragment and then pass these two wires, one from the styloid and one from the ulna, radius to ulna. And you can see we have been able to maintain a good position of the articular fragment, which was depressed. But this is not possible every time, but it is worth trying in some of these cases and it can give you an excellent reduction and you should immobilize them in plaster till you get the fracture gluey and they can do excellent in their function. Then this is a elderly patient with both radius and ulna lower end. And you can see that I have fixed the wire from ulna to radius to get the stability and immobilized it in an above elbow plaster with good result. Another comminuted lower end radius in an elderly patient. And you can see a volar displacement with a big volar fragment, and again you can see the use of a dorsal tube volar wire, and you have to be careful that this wire should not be too long, otherwise this can cause injury to the median nerve. Another comminuted lower end radius with radial ulnar subluxation, and you can see that this particular patient had three wires again, and we could get a good stability for the radial ulnar joint, and 6 weeks of immobilization in a plaster. And this is again, this patient came for something else, and at the end of 2 years, we could get his functional photographs and had done extremely well at the end of 2 years. This is another intra-articular comminuted. We tried fixing it with K wires, but then I realized that this is not maintaining the position. So we had to augment the fixation with an external fixator. And at the end of 4 weeks, we removed the fixator, put him in a plaster for another 3 weeks, and then removed the plaster. And the patient could do very well. This is his function. Another 70-year female, again, distal end radius fracture, and you can see a gross collapse. And in this particular patient, we tried putting K wires, and on table, we realized that it is not possible. But we had kept the alternative ready. So we had to put a plate, but even the plate was not enough, because you can see that the radial ulnar joint was completely disrupted, which you cannot stabilize by any plate. So in addition to putting a volar locking plate, I had to make use of two K wires. So this is an augmentation of fixation of a plate with K wires. So this is another indication wherein you can use K wires in distal radius fractures. And another one, 55-year, he's a general surgeon. He was treated outside. Unfortunately, this was the X-ray which he brought from his old doctor. And I'm sorry for the quality because it was not in my hand. This was pinned with two wires which were going through the fracture site, and they were not giving any stability. So we had to convert this into a plate, and we had to do a tension band wiring for the ulnar styloid also. Being a surgeon and his working hand, we had to see that we could get the best possible result. And you can see at the end of 6 months, you know, he has got full function of his wrist. Well, the K-wire is not answer for everything. There are some disadvantages of K-wire fixation, especially in osteoporotic bone. The hold is not very strong. So I have tried and used some wires with the threaded K-wires. But then the removal of these wires is sometimes a problem. You have to take the patient under anesthesia and then only you can remove. Otherwise, the non-threaded wires can be removed very easily in the outdoor. In spite of K-wires, in some comminuted fractures in porotic bones, there are still chances of collapse, and you should be open to accept and convert it into a plate. You cannot address all the fracture types with K-wires. There is some incidence of pin track infection, especially in porotic bone, because of the loosening of the wires. And one has to keep the plaster immobilization for longer time than putting a plate so that you can get good union. And if the patient is not given proper instructions of doing physiotherapy, then this delayed mobilization can lead to stiffness and reflex sympathetic dystrophy. So the take-home message is, the lower end radius fractures is a very common injury. K-wire fixation is a good option in elderly with comorbidities for the reasons which I have already explained. In osteoporotic bones, locking plates can still give better results than putting K-wires all the time. I would like to finish off my talk with the recent updates from the Orthopedic Knowledge Update of AOS, which is the latest 13th volume. In that, they have compared different series of patients from 150 to more than 300 patients, wherein they have used in osteoporotic patients in some of them plates and in some of them the percutaneous K wires. And in all the series, what they have found is that at the end of 3 to 6 months, the patients having volar plates or locking plates, they have better maintenance of the length of radius, better articular congruity. The patients have better grip strength at the end of 3 and 6 months and better range of movement. But at the end of 1 year, the patients with K-wire, where these ideal situation is not maintained, and the patients with open reduction and internal fixation with a lock plate, at the end of 1 year, in most of the patients, the functional results are almost same. So I think in patients with low economic strata, with multiple comorbidities, I think a K-wire is still an excellent option which one should consider, and one should master this particular technique. I thank you very much for your patient listening and giving me this opportunity to share my views on this particular topic. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Kakatkar sir. It was an excellent presentation. And K-wires is very commonly done, especially in the periphery and in the rural setups. And for the low economic strata, it is a very boon. So thank you very much for enlightening us on this very important topic. Now we'll move ahead.
If we can take it up right now, because as I explained to you, have to leave a little early.
Yeah, yes.
If there are any questions, I'll be very happy to answer.
Yeah. Is there any question to Kakatkar, sir, from other faculties or from the audience?
Sir, are you practicing the 5K-wire technique?
Not so. I usually use 3.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Sir, for how long do you immobilize after doing K-wires in a volar button kind of a fracture? Like
6 weeks.
Wonderful results.
6 weeks.
For 6 weeks in an above elbow.
Above elbow plaster, yes.
Okay. Yeah.
But I am very particular about explaining the exercises for the finger, the shoulders, right from day one, you know.
Right.
And if you are careful about these, then I think the chances of getting stiffness and the other problems related to the prolonged immobilization are minimized considerably. Yes, Pankaj?
How often you get late collapse after removal of the K-wires?
Well, in about 5% cases, we do see some late collapse. But then if I have little doubts, then as I have shown in one of the cases, I prefer to keep one of the wires which has got a better hold, because many times you see that when you have taken out the plaster, some of the wires are already totally loose at the end of 6 weeks. So they have to come out. But the wire which has got a good hold, if you are a little worried that it is likely to collapse further, I would prefer to keep that wire and put the patient on mobilization after removal of the plaster. So that takes care of this.
So 5% of the patient will have a late collapse.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir. Now we'll move on to the next case by Dr. Pankaj Jindal, sir. Interesting case. Yeah.
Can you see my slide?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Segedar. Thank you, MOA, for this opportunity. I'm going to talk about fracture distal radius. Boy had a fracture of the distal end of the radius, and this was treated with the K-wire. And he was with a pediatric orthopedic surgeon, so no question about that. He was in good hands here. And he was followed up regularly, and at the end of 2 months, the conclusion was an excellent healing. After 2 months, so this is where we started. The fixation was done, and the wires were removed, and it went on to good healing. But at the end of 6 years, this is the unaffected side, and this is the unaffected side here. So this is where we had began after removal of the wire, and it ended up in a premature shortening because of premature physial closure here. So a late affection is possibility because of affection of the physis in a skeletally immature patient here. And this is where he presented 6 years down the line with pain in the wrist, reduced range of motion, and a deformity and a prominent ulna here. And he required an osteotomy and the lengthening of the radius here. And this is where we began. We restored the height. Yes, the distance between the distal radius and ulna is increased. I just could not reduce this. I could not reduce it, lengthen the radius further, because probably the cartilage was deformed as well in 6 years gap, which had happened since the injury here. So I thought he might have a problem with the distal radial ulnar joint. So after the surgery, I counseled the relatives and I said, probably he might be a candidate for a second surgery for stabilization of the distal radial ulnar joint if he has a problem there. So what happened? It went on to healing here at 14 months post-surgery here. And this for the range of motion and the distal radial ulnar joint was absolutely stable. So the point that I wanted to highlight here is a wire through an open physis is a potential problem. Long-term results are extremely important. In the short term, patient may have a good result, but in long-term, premature physial closure is a probability here. And they may end up with symptomatic stage and they might require a surgery here. And therefore, further, we must be ready for a stage surgery if there's involvement of the distal radial ulnar joint and stability and clicking here. I'll talk of a second patient here. This patient had a fracture of the distal radius here. The pisiform is in the anterior part of the scaphoid here, and therefore this is the lateral view. But what we do notice here, the ulna is more prominent dorsally here. Another view of the same patient, and what we notice here, the ulna is almost dislocated dorsally here. He was treated conservatively. The most important thing that we need to see here is just do not concentrate only on the PA view, but also on the lateral view and see if the ulna is superimposed on the radius in a true lateral position here. We obtained a PA view, we obtained a CT scan here. Yes, there was involvement of the ulnar fragment here. And what we do notice here, the ulna is going dorsally because the ulnar fragment, the dorsal ulnar fragment is involved here. So we decided if we can stabilize this fragment here, this will take the ulna also back into an alignment here. So I went in from the dorsal aspect here, put in the plate here. Yes, this plate could have been more ulnar, but this is the view I got on the C-arm that moment. Having put in the plate and stabilized the dorsal ulnar corner here, I further reinforced with two K wires from the ulna into the radius. With respectfully, Dr. Kakatkar showed wires going from the ulna into the radius to the articular joint. We prefer to keep these wires away from the articular surface so that we save as much of the articular cartilage here. And these wires are kept more projecting on the radial side so that in case these wires break, we can pull them out more safely and they are not a problem here. So we put in these 2K wires. Again, as I said, this plate could have been more ulnar, but this is the view I found on the C-arm at the time of surgery here. Did it work? Yes, we could restore the full pronation supination here. Yes, there is some restriction of palmar flexion, but dorsiflexion is very good here. An important message I would like to share with this patient here. Patient had a fracture of the distal end of the radius, and he had been plated earlier. But what we notice here, the ulnar fragment is not having any purchase here. The previous view did show a purchase, did show a hold, apparent hold here on the ulnar fragment here, but not true hold. And what we notice here, down the line, this ulnar fragment had collapsed. And how long? It just took less than 6 weeks for this to present to us here. And therefore, very important once you see these fractures to see, have a hold on the ulnar fragment, because these are the ones who this have to be operated here. Because of the involvement of the ulnar fragment here, there's involvement of the radial ulnar joint, and there's loss of pronation supination, as you can see here. So because of this, this has to be restored here. We obtained a CT scan. Here's the metacarpal, capitate, lunate, and you see the lunate fragment of the radius has telescope and shortened here. So what our aim was to do an osteotomy here, put this volar fragment more dorsally and distally here, and migrate it more dorsally here. Again, in the axial view, we see on the CT scan, the plate is having only a purchase on the radial side, but not on the ulnar side here. And this needs a purchase. This has to be repositioned so that we have a good alignment with the ulna here. Again, 3D view, no purchase on this fragment here. Further, you see the whole carpus has collapsed and there is a volar subluxation of the carpus because of malposition of the plate here. Again, the incision is going more radially. Probably the incision would have been more toward the medial epicondyle here. So after the plate removal, we have a better view of what is happening to the fragment. We should do an osteotomy here so that we can restore the lunate fragment here. This is the model that we obtained. We had a 5 to 6 and 8 millimeter osteotome, narrow blades. We did an osteotomy here so that this fragment was made free here. And once this had been made free here, we restored the height and then we put in 2 K wires coming from the radial side onto the ulnar side here so that we can have a hold on this fragment here. Once fragment was in alignment, we replace it with a plate here. Now the important thing with the plate is the screw is going first into the ulnar fragment rather than onto the radial fragment. Once you have a hold here, then you are safe. So an important thing is to have a hold on the ulnar fragment here, and then you complete your fixation here. So this is where we began, and we shifted, removed this plate here and shifted the plate more ulnar side so that we have a hold on this fragment here. So always, always, always remember your purchase should be on the ulnar fragment before you go on to the radial fixation. So the plate has to move more radially. Your plate has to be moved more ulnarward. So this is where we began and this is where we ended. Try to have at least 2 screws, if not 2, because depending on the fracture size of the fragment, you might get a purchase on only 1, but try to have 2 screws into the ulnar fragment here. So the lesson that we learn here is you should have a hold on the ulnar fragment. With this, I think Dr. Sigidhar, before he interrupts, I think I'll stop here. So I thank you very much, Dr. Sigidhar, for giving me this opportunity, and I stop my presentation here.
Pankaj, can I ask you a question?
Yes, sir.
Regarding the first case that you showed, you know, there were 2 problems which the first surgeon treating, you know, these fractures can be, if at all you want to fix in pediatric age group, you should spare the physis and then fix the K wires.
Right, absolutely.
And one of the techniques which can be used is instead of passing the wires from distal to proximal, you can pass the wires from proximal to distal just to hold the fragment. Because in these children, the healing potential is so good that you have to just hold it if at all you want to. Most of the patients, actually, you can go without a K wire also in these patients. The second one that I want to know is that when you showed the X-ray of shortening, there was a lytic shadow in the lower end of the radius. So was there any focus of infection in that area?
No, there was no infection.
Because there was a persistent shadow, radiolucent shadow seen in the distal radius.
No, and there was no infection. No.
Okay. There. And in the situations wherein you can't get the radio-ulnar joint in proper alignment, why did you not think of shortening the ulna a bit and getting the radial ulnar joint aligned?
I was young. Yes, I have used that technique of shortening the ulna. But here in this particular, because the next case was of ulna shortening also, but I thought I have a watch in front of me. I thought I'll exceed my time. So okay. I stopped here. But yes, that's another option that we have.
Okay.
But as you rightly said, yes, you should avoid passing a wire from the physis because I have several patients where the nice fixation done earlier ended up in a premature collapse leading to a grotesque deformity. So avoid wires through the open physis in a child.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, sir. Now we'll move on to the next presentation. Dr. Rajesh Gandhi was to present the case, but he has some meeting. So he has sent his video presentation. So I request Supriya to run presentation of Dr. Rajesh Gandhi on role of JACE and external fixator in treating fracture lower and radius with osteoporosis. Dr. Rajesh Gandhi is a senior orthopedic.
Good evening, everybody. Yeah. Today, I'm going to discuss about the role of external fixator in a fracture of the distal radius. Now, the options of treatment have already been discussed for the fractures of the distal radius. They are closed reduction pinning, closed reduction plus external fixator, or one of the treatments supplemented by percutaneous pinning, then the open reduction in plating. Now, which method to use and how to do it, whether to operate or not to operate, which method to use, does the age matter? These are the questions which arises when one is planning about the treatment modalities for the fractures of the lower and of the radius. Now, what are the goals of the treatment? The anatomical reduction of the fracture, restoration of the radial length is important, giving rise to a stable and wrist and DRUJ, early restoration of the movement results if it is done. Now, the principles of the successful use of the external fixators is, first and foremost, one has to do the careful assessment of the fracture pattern. The meticulous surgical approach has to be planned. The fixation device should be decided. The use of the judicious use of the combined methods can be done. The careful postoperative monitoring and early rehabilitation will ensure the good results. Now, what do I need when I'm trying to do the, when I'm planning an external fixator? The components which require are as shown in the pictures. There are K wires, there are link joints, and the connecting rods. Now, K wires or the pins can be threaded or plain. We use the plain K wires. The threaded K wires we are no more using. The connecting rods are smooth versus the rough rods. The smooth rods are being preferred over the rough rods. Now, the link joints are different types of link joints are available in our external fixator. JACE external fixator link joints, Esculap link joints, and the AO type universal joints are also available. K-wire insertion should be done. Plain K-wires are used. They are preferred over the threaded K-wires. Once in a while, the Shanks pins are used. The small cruciate incision is made over the site when I am going to insert. The low speed drilling should be used. The while applying the frame, the wires are pre-stressed. Where do I apply it? It is like crossing the road midway or crossing at the zebra crossing. It is safer to cross the road at the zebra crossing. That's how one has to do so. So what should be the way it should be applied? The pin placement should be in a safe corridor if one is aware of their anatomy. So know your anatomy very well before you are applying. Now, this is a safe corridor, what we use the word. This is taken from the AO. The picture is depicting what are the important structures. You avoid the important structures and put in the wires accordingly. The attaching the external fixed assembly. To insert the K wires in a second and third metacarpal at the base as well as at the metacarpal region in the distal part. The proximal K wires are inserted in the proximal radius and they are connected to the link joints. This is what is the final outcome. Now, what are the types of frame which can be used for the fixation of the external fixator? Now, there are radial and ulnar frames, there are uniplanar frames, and there are biplanar frames. Now, the radial and ulnar frames were used initially, which is no more being used. Now, the K-wires used in the metacarpal are 1.5 to 1.8 millimeter K-wires. In the forearm, 2 to 2.5 millimeter wires are used depending on the person's bone strength and bone diameter. The second and third metacarpals, usually they have a 1.5 to 1.8 millimeters. The first fracture to the proximal site in the K wires inserted in the radius is a 1 inch, at least 1 inch proximal to the metacarpal. And second K wire is at least 10 centimeters prior to the proximal to that. So the distance between the two K wires is kept at 10 centimeters. The adjustment of the frame is, the hinges are locked. The distraction to achieve the ligamentotaxis and the fracture reduction, the alignment is checked and the position of the frame is corrected in a palmar or a dorsiflexion, radial and ulnar deviation. If the fracture geometry is not sufficiently restored, open reduction and internal fixation is done. Percutaneous pinning or a combination of methods are required. Now, dorsal tilt is corrected by holding the distal fragments by K wires on the corrected and in an overhead beam. This becomes a little complicated frame. The radial and ulnar frame is as shown in the picture and diagram, which is no more being used now. Uniplanar joint sparing frames are being used, which is also we would prefer not to use nowadays, because it does not offer as much stability. Now the standard method is a biplanar or a biplanar joint spanning. This is what is the standard method. This offers a very good stability without any early mobilization can be started on day one. Now this is the result which we can show you after the immediately after the external fixator. And this is the final result. Now, another illustrative case, a 78 years male who was treated with a cast, 6 weeks old injury, it was maluniting. This is the time he presented to us. What was done was, this is the picture outside the cast. What was done was close reduction was attempted. We were fortunate enough to, because the fracture was mobile, we were able to distract it. We distracted and put in an X-fix. We augmented the fixation by two cross K wires, and to our good relief and satisfaction, at 8 weeks, the fracture was uniting. Now, why there is so much of a practice variation? Is the available evidence enough to cause so much of variation? Because there are people who prefer plating, there are people who prefer K wires, there are people who prefer only close reduction, and there are people who prefer X-fix and combination of the methods. Is it depending on the variation, depending on the evidence which is presented, or it is a personal preferences? Now, intra-articular fractures pose a difficult problems. And since different modalities are available, there are proponents of the plating and proponents of external fixator. Now, majority of the people prefer the plating over the X-fix. Now, X-fix as a definitive treatment, in our opinion, is an underutilized modality. Is the decision governed by the evidence? Is the decision governed by the age? Is it decided by the financial status of the patient or area in which you are practicing? Area of the, whether it is in a rural area, in a semi-urban area or an urban area. Well, lot of these factors govern, and evidence does matter. But what is evidence? Let us look at that. Other factors, we are not trying to look at that because other factors have a lot of personal preferences creeping in. Now, or is it fashionable to do the plating? That is what I always used to ask myself. Or is it a herd mentality? People are doing plating and should not be left behind. Is it that mentality? Or is it you will try to, new gadget is being given to a kid, he wants to play with it? Or is it the new gadget which fascinates him? So the likewise the plates fascinates you and you do it. Is it that way? Now, let's look at the evidence, what it tells us. Now, the advantages of platings are plenty. It gives anatomic reduction, early mobilization, good union rate, and less post-op rehab, early return to the function. There are disadvantages. The open procedure, chances of infection are higher. Anatomical reduction is not possible, particularly dorsal fragments. Or if at all you want to do the fragment, then fragment specific and multiple platings. Well, my boss, Dr. Tarapurala, used to say that you are putting in a Lohar chal inside. That is what I do believe, that there are too many implants in the wrist has too many complications, tendon ruptures and other problems associated with that. The postoperative scars are quite troublesome at times. Then the plate-related tendon ruptures are more in the dorsal plating. And median nerve damage, though it is rare, but it is reported. Vascular damages are rare, but it is reported. Now, external fixator, it is a versatile equipment. It is something which can be mastered very easily. It's a minimally invasive procedure. Anesthesia required is a short anesthesia. The chances of infection are lesser and very easy to master the procedure. And because it is a versatile, because it is, you can, according to your need, you can change the absolute advantage, I mean, the fixation of the fixation of the wires, wire placement, and the reduction can be achieved very easily. Now, what are the disadvantages? As it is anatomical, reduction is always not feasible. Well, that is something which needs to be looked into. Now, the pintract infection is another source of a problem. Believe me, if one is taking a good care of the pins post-operatively, chances of pintract infection reduces drastically. Also, if you have pre-stressed the wires, if you have taken the skin incision with a cruciate incision while inserting the pin and use the low-speed drill, then the necrosis of the skin is lesser and the pintract infection is practically nullified. Now, stiffness of the fingers. The commonest cause of the stiffness of the finger is over-distraction. So, over-distraction should be avoided. So, because it is working on the principles of the ligamentotaxis, there are times we have a tendency to over-distract. When you over-distract, then the fingers become stiff. So, mobilization, adequate mobilization from day one and a proper application of the frame prevents the stiffness of the fingers. The wrist stiff after the surgery is over, well, that also again, once the rehab is started, one has to work little, but that is something which is not difficult because you have achieved a ligamentotaxis. So the stiffness of the wrist is not so common as it is common with other modalities. Now the rehab, people say that rehab starts a prolonged way for the simple reason that we have kept the external fixator for a little longer while. But about 6 weeks or 4 weeks, when it is used as a definitive treatment, then the fixation is kept for the 6 weeks minimum. So that is the time the rehab starts at that stage. So that's why slightly delayed rehab. And it is cumbersome to carry, yes. But then you have to cut the wires short, cover it up well. And it is not as cumbersome as it is being thought of. Now, the what is the criteria for the outcome which has decided for the wrist stiffness, for the functionalities, dash core, grip strength, finger and wrist joint movement, and radiological and arthroscopic evaluation is being done. Now, what the is it really necessary to restore the radial anatomical parameters? We were just discussing that maintaining the radial length, maintaining the anatomical structures is very important. Now, this article is an eye-opener. This was published in Injury Journal in 2014, where Dario et al., they have shown the experience, their experience suggests that ulnar variance in the volar tilt are the most important radiographic parameters to be restored to obtain the good functional outcome in distal radius fractures. The small variations of the other radiographic parameters seem not to affect the final outcome at the minimum 3 years follow-up. So it does burst the myth that if all the parameters are not being achieved, still one can get a very good result with any modalities of a treatment which we have tried. Now here there is a comparative analysis of the external and the internal fixation in the lower radial articular fractures were done by the Soumya Ghosh and his colleagues at Carr Medical College, Kolkata. Their opinion was that external fixation in the volar buttress plate produces almost equivalent functional results in the distal radial articular fractures, with the volar buttress plate having better anatomical result and then the external fixation in the present study. But what their functionality was there, the functionality at the end of 3 months, at the end of 6 months, was near same. So it does tell that though the immediate functionality is better, but overall functionality is same. And of course, anatomical reduction is better in a plate. This is a paper again in a Chinese Journal of Traumatology published in 2018. Now, there they have compared the locking plate versus external fixation of a type C distal radius fractures. They had done the meta-analysis. Wang and his colleagues in Chu Yang Hospital. What they found, that there was a small difference between the two groups on imaging examination. The locking plate has an advantage on maintaining the reduction. However, no significant difference regarding outcome has been found between the two groups. The external fixator versus the lower locking plate in unstable dorsally displaced fractures. This study was published, and what they had shown that there was no difference regarding all the scores which we were mentioning, like dash score and the range of movement or the grip strength. The reoperation was 21% in the volar locking plate compared to 14% in the external fixator group. The osteoarthritis rate was 42% in the volar locking plate group compared with 28% in external fixator group. So what does it conclude? That 3 years after the surgery for the unstable dorsally displaced distal radius fractures, the clinical and radiological results for volar locking plate and external fixator were comparable. This was published as late as Journal of Hand Surgery in 2019. So it does make us think, if the results in the unstable fractures also are similar or comparable, are we doing justice by putting in a plate, by putting in, this is one viewpoint. It no way suggests that the plating should not be done. Now, here again, there is another paper which was published in 2013. They had done the meta-analysis, Esposito and his colleagues. What there was a very little clinical difference between open reduction, internal fixation with a plate fixation and X-fix group. The ORIF with plate fixation provides a lower dash score, better restoration of a radial length and reduced infection rates as compared to external fixation for the treatment of distal radius fractures. What does the recommendations of the AOAs? AOAs cannot recommend for or against the locking plates in patients over the age of 55 who are treated operatively. The strength of recommendation was inconclusive. What does the inconclusive evidence mean? The evidence from a single low quality study or a conflicting finding that do not allow a recommendation for or against the intervention. That is what it means. So they also are not able to 100% recommend. Now, in a nutshell, there is no clear evidence over one treatment which is superior over others. The plating and the external fixation both are good treatment. Do whatever one is more conversant with. Our recommendation for the external fixation in distal radius comminuted fracture is severely comminuted fracture where the bag of bones are there. No other modalities would offer a good result than the external fixation. Then open fractures, well, external fixation would provide a stability for the other procedures. If at all one has to do the flap, etc., then it can be of use. Then a rim fracture where the hold by other method is questionable. Very old patient and or unfit for a longer anesthesia where the cost is a major factor. Thank you very much for the patient hearing. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rajesh Gandhi, sir. It was an excellent presentation, and this has been proved over a period of time as a boon for the low socioeconomic patients and in the treatment of fracture lower end radius with osteoporotic bones. So we'll move on to the next presentation by Dr. Abhijit Vahegaonkar. He will be talking on role of locking compression plate for treating the osteoporotic lower end radius fractures. Dr. Abhijit Vahegaonkar is an hand surgeon from Pune, and he is an executive committee member of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association, very dynamic surgeon. Over to Dr. Abhijit.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. It's an honor to be amongst all the stalwarts of MOA and the Andhra Pradesh Orthopedic Association, and I thank you for the opportunity. My task is to talk about role of locking plates in the management of distal radius fractures, and I do not have any conflict of interest. So this in brief is the scope of the talk. We'll be trying to identify the patterns that will require fixation to understand classification systems and apply them. And this was already done, so I won't belabor too much on this. The approach and the anatomy, understand implant designs and indication and the caveats. Let's begin with this case presentation. This was the X-ray that the patient presented with from a previous hospital. And he was treated non-operatively in a splint, and the reduction looks reasonably okay and quite good. And 5 weeks later, however, he presented with this collapse that would have been averted should the treating surgeon initially would have identified the instability pattern. So with that little prelude, let us also look at another example. So this is a patient who is 55 years of age, had a comminuted fracture. This is the lateral view that shows the dorsal comminution as well as the volar comminution with angulation. And we initially tried close reduction and K-wire because that was a suggestion of my senior colleagues. And we put in a K-wire and the posterior anterior view looks very good, quite acceptable. But lo and behold, when we look at the lateral view, you would appreciate the volar comminution and the slight angulation that is still present. And this perhaps might not have been appropriately addressed by just K-wires and with a cast. So we went ahead and did an open reduction internal fixation and were able to have a robust fixation with restoration of the normal anatomical parameters and mobilization at an early time frame. So let us understand the problem that we face when dealing with distal radius fractures. And the interesting part is that almost everyone from orthopedic surgeons to hand surgeons to trauma surgeons will treat these fractures. And we more often than not discuss our successes and not our failures. And that kind of serves as an impediment to understanding how we may improve. So there are approximately 6.8 million fractures per year. Extremities are most commonly involved. Distal radius is the most common fracture. And after the hip, the second most common fracture that we end up seeing is a fracture of the distal radius. And we now know that there is a bimodal distribution of a low velocity fractures in the elderly age group and a high velocity fracture with severe comminution in the younger age group. And this is usually compounded by osteoporosis in the aging population. So the problem is that the metaphysis is a relatively weak point with a low cortical to cancellous bone ratio. And then the thinner cortical bone usually fails in bending and in extension. So this is also susceptible to osteoporosis at this area. And that is what it makes more prone to developing different fracture patterns. We need to identify the normal parameters and try to restore these anatomical parameters, be it with close reduction, pins and plaster, external fixator, or plating, whatever the modality might be. The goal of the treatment should be to restore these parameters in terms of radial inclination, radial height, and the volar tilt, and to restore the so-called teardrop, which is of paramount importance in reducing these fractures, especially in the coronal shear fractures. As long as you are able to do this, I think the outcomes will be reasonably good, irrespective of what modality we are using. So a fall onto an outstretched hand with the wrist in extension will result in a fracture of the distal radius because the subchondral cortical bone is pretty strong. The volar ligaments are strong, especially the long and the short radiolunate, as well as the radius capitate ligaments. And the dorsal compressive force is usually what results in these fractures occurring. So as was rightly discussed by Dr. Rajesh Gandhi, in the previous talk, we know that the distal radius fractures are very common and they are likely to become more common with the aging population and the increased life expectancy. However, there is no solid evidence out there as to what works best. At best, we have conflicting evidence and we have weak evidence to prove or disprove the advantage of one modality over the other. let us try to understand and recognize the unstable fracture patterns. And to do that, we have the AAOS guidelines, and these are all out there for you to read. But I think more importantly, we should understand and appreciate this important paper that was published by LaFontaine in 1989 in Injury. And they described five risk factors that are important, and a sixth one was added later on. So combination in dorsal angulation of more than 20 degrees and intra-articular involvement, fracture of the ulna, any shortening of greater than 5 millimeters and osteoporosis render the fractures unstable. And then to just take the discussion a little further, we also have something called the Stewart score that help you in decision making. The classification system has already been described and was discussed in greater detail by the preceding speakers. I will not belabor too much on this, but suffice it to say that all classification systems have a great amount of an intra-observer as well as an inter-observer variability, and this should be kept in mind when we are dealing with these fractures. Of all the fracture classification patterns, the column concept described Rickley and Regazzoni perhaps has the greatest application in terms of predicting the treatment patterns. This again, I won't belabor too much on, but suffice it to say that the concept of using this this classification is to identify the columns and the components and then try and endeavor to provide a stable fixation of these components. Start with the simplest technique and then you advance this technique as needed to address all the fragments. And this has perhaps laid the foundation for the so-called fracture fragment-specific fixation. So the treatment goals, again, irrespective of what modality we are using, are to get the fracture to heal, to try and restore as normal function as possible in a pain-free range of movement. And the history of treatment of distal radius fractures has been evolving and continues to do so. Again, this has been described, and my task is to talk about internal fixation using plates, and that is what I will stick to. So the theory of volar plating or plate fixation is to accomplish anatomical reduction and secure an articular congruency with increased stability and rigidity that ultimately allow for an increased load to failure and allows for early range of motion. Again, the caveat is the same AAOS study failed to provide any evidence to support early movement vis-a-vis a late range of movement as an advantage with these modalities in the long-term outcome. So the theoretical advantage of distal radius plating also does come with its own set of complications that has been discussed, but there are certain advantages of using a plate, and the volar aspect especially does have a potential space that avoids tendon irritation and allows for better plate fixation should you have enough experience in training in performing these surgeries. The watershed line plates designed to stay proximal to the watershed line and then cross the watershed line for the more distal fractures have been devised and have been described. And again, I won't belabor too much on this, but suffice it to say that no treatment pattern, be it plaster, be it fixators, be it pins or be it plates, they are not devoid of their own set of complications. So these complications have been recognized, have been described. Again, I won't belabor too much on this, but the locking plate has perhaps been a game changer after its description by Jorge Orbe in the early 2000 era. And the threaded head, the rigid fixed angle, and kind of the limitation of the contact between the bone and the plate kind of acts as an internal external fixator, and that is the touted advantage of using fixed angle volar plates. So this is a very stable construct and provides a good rigidity. Again, there have been modifications in the designs of these plates with proximal and distal rows, allowing for pegs, allowing for locking screws. So it basically creates a 3D scaffold or a raft-like structure that will support the subchondral osteoporotic bone and then allow it to heal while you are trying to reconstruct the distal radius parameters. There are refinements that are all out there for, I'm sure most of you must be using all these advanced plates. Here is a schematic diagram that highlights how a locking plate acts and works. Again, these are principles that are very fundamental and very basic, and we are all acquainted with this with these principles. There are several designs, and I'm sure that every time you go to or attend a conference, you will come across or stumble across a new design that has been developed in that year. But how does this work? So the subchondral screw or the pegs basically need to be positioned properly, and they act as a cantilever. And this cantilever allows for the forces or the stresses from the carpus onto the radius to be mitigated, and then allow for a buttressing effect ultimately, and to also allow for addressing the dorsal fragments. In fact, the initial advantage of using the volar plate was touted to be the ability to also catch the dorsal fragments and avoid a dorsal exposure. The typical approach is the Orbe approach, wherein you take a V-shaped extension across the flexion crease, you expose the flexor carpi radialis, go through the subsheet, protect the tendon and the nerves, especially the lateral cutaneous branch of the median nerve. You develop the space of perona, and then you identify the pronator quadratus. You would elevate the pronator quadratus in a manner that would leave some cuff of the muscle so that you can suture it back. And then you would pronate the proximal fragment to gain interfocal exposure. And you would reduce position and secure, place your plate with a provisional fixation. And then you would bring in your screws and perform the final fixation that would allow for as anatomical reduction as possible. And we prefer to close the pronator quadratus back on again. So what is the evidence in favor of volar fixation? There have been several papers, and the first paper that was published by Jorge Armendiego Fernandez way back in 2002 was the first paper that looked at these modality of treatment, and they reported quite good outcomes with some extensive tendon irritation. 2004, they came back again with a larger series in patients more than 75 years of age, and 9 were bone grafted, 77 grip strength return, 19 were pain-free, 2 had mild pain, and all healed and returned to work or daily activities. There are several papers out there looking at the cohort of patients who fall in the elderly age group with osteoporosis. This was a large series by Rohit Arora from Vienna. And again, they reported on their outcomes. And another study by Dean Smith from Gainesville, Florida and Houston, Texas. And again, they reported their outcomes to be quite favorable with their own share of complications. The support continues. There are several papers that talk in favor. However, we need to be critical in our analysis. What are the limitations of volar plating? I think one of the biggest limitations is loss of fixation if not used appropriately, intra-articular hardware, collapse of the fracture, tendon irritation, nerve injury, and failure to achieve adequate reduction. So all of these should be recognized, should be identified, and kept in mind when you are dealing with these fractures. So complications basically reveal the limitation and the importance of preoperative planning. And things to consider when you're dealing with any distal radius fracture, especially when you're considering an open reduction internal fixation, would be the need for any additional approach. Do not hesitate to go dorsal if you would need to. Maneuvers to facilitate volar exposure, additional modalities in terms of external fixation, K-wires, or additional pins and plates, and again, alternative approaches also should be kept in mind and should be used wherever and whenever necessary. Again, there are certain limitations of volar plating which have been very well described and are discussed a lot in all conferences. The trend is towards fixation. There are newer designs that are being described. There are implants that have been used in a plate and nail form also for porotic fractures. And also very quick passing note about dorsal fixation of distal radius fractures. These are also techniques that are useful for dealing with these fractures. We make a midline longitudinal incision. You identify the EPL, evacuate the hematoma, elevate the third and the fourth compartment, incise the capsule, reduce and fix, and work from the easiest to the most difficult or complex, and never hesitate to bone graft. A quick video to show the dorsal midline incision, and then you identify the extensor pollicis longus with the hematoma in the third extensor compartment. We release the extensor pollicis longus and keep it extracompartmental. We elevate the third, the fourth and the second extensor compartment off the dorsal aspect of the radius. And then you would reduce bone graft and fix these fractures with the pre-contoured plates that are available from different companies and different implant designs to allow for reduction and restoration of the anatomy of the distal radius in these fractures. What is of paramount importance is soft tissue closure. Sometimes you have these fragments that are attached to the capsule that can be secured to the plate with non-absorbable sutures, braided sutures, and that will allow for stability. And then closing the compartments, and these are steps which are extremely important in preventing and avoiding irritation and tendon ruptures. We very seldom remove the dorsal plates as well. So in summary, distal radius fractures will continue to challenge us. We need to understand our failures of fixation to improve our future success. We need to assess the fractures carefully, and we need to understand that every fracture is unique and should be treated as such, and it is the surgeon and not the hardware that makes for the final outcome. With that, I thank you for the attention and the opportunity to speak here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Abhishek, for this useful presentation.
Thank you, sir.
There is definitely a role of polar plating, that locking compression in osteoporotic fractures, where we need a stability as well as early mobilization. So now we have one case from by Dr. Varid Altaf. Dr. Varid Altaf is a hand surgeon at SIOR Pune and very dynamic person. I request Varid to complete his case and then we'll take a discussion.
Yes. Can you see my screen?
Yeah.
Thank you. At the outset, I would like to thank Maharashtra Orthopedic Association, Dr. Prakash Sigedar, sir, for giving me an opportunity. I'll quickly share, being the last talk, and I think most of the things have been covered, including all the complications. So I'll share one of the case. So this is a 45-year-old male with this particular kind of a fracture at the right hand dominant and a fresh trauma. So initially this patient was treated elsewhere. So we don't have the CT scans or any other investigation. So retrospectively, I have collected all the previous X-rays. So this is it's like a dorsal comminuted distal and radius fracture. So the initial surgeon had operated this patient on day one. And this is the post-operative X-ray on the day one of the surgery, in which the external fixator along with the K wires have been done. And the initial surgeon accepted, found it reasonable, and he continued the same. And then on post-op day seven, the X-ray was taken again, and this is the position which was found. And at this particular point, the surgeon has felt that he needs to revise this. Probably if we see there are certain problems in this, the reduction is not looking proper in a lateral view. We can see there's a dorsal displacement, the DRUJ is not well maintained, and there's a significant collapse as well. So the patient was taken to the operation theater again, and on the 10th day of the initial surgery, a revision was done. This kind of a fixation was again attempted. Again, a closed reduction was done. So second surgery was removing of the external fixator and putting in multiple K wires in different planes in the hope of achieving a better reduction, which was not achieved initially. And then this was continued. And 2 weeks following the second surgery, 1 week apart X-rays, these were the X-rays. And again, we can see there is probably a loss of reduction. And again, the parameters, like we have discussed, all the radiological indices have not been maintained. And however, this was continued for some long time. And
this is the 3 months post injury x-ray, and at this time the patient presented to us, and a patient had a completely stiff wrist in pronation, like 30 degree of mid prone position, and a very limited range of movements. This was the presentation x-ray. He had 20 degrees in pronation and palmar flexion of 20 degrees, dorsiflexion of 40 degrees, very weak grip strength and a visible deformity because of the prominence of ulna, and there's a dorsal subluxation of the carpus. So at this particular time, this was the right time to intervene, and we got some CT scan done just to do our pre-operative preparation for any surgical reconstruction which we have to do. And we could see this kind of a picture. It was actually not completely healed as well, but maybe some kind of a strong fibrous union was there, and there was a gross dorsal displacement and dorsal subluxation of the carpus. You can see in these sagittal cuts, and a significant collapse you can see in the coronal plane. So then we started planning about, we thought of doing a dorsal approach, since being a dorsal deformity, and we could target it and achieve a good approach on the dorsal side, open wedge osteotomy, maybe a dorsal radial, so that a palmar tilt and as well as the radial inclination is maintained, a plate fixation, SOS Dirac procedure intraoperatively to decide, and bone grafting, of course. So these are the intraoperative images. A dorsal radial kind of an open wedge osteotomy was done. This is the these are the C-arm images, and that is Dr. Abhijit has wonderfully explained the dorsal approach to the radius. So the same approach, and that was the dorsal. That's the lamellar spreader trying to open up the dorsolateral cortex and provisionally fixing it with some K wires before we could recheck again and then go ahead and do a definitive fixation. So a Dirac procedure was done earlier, because sometimes it's very hard when we're doing these malunited distal and radius fractures to achieve the correct position of the distal block of the articular surface of the radius. The ulna may not, sometimes it blocks the reduction, and you may end up crushing the metafascial bone in an attempt of correcting the tilt. So that was provisionally fixed, and this is then it was fixed with the dorsal locking plate. That was, and that wedge was again, the graft from the ulna. And the head of the ulna was packed in onto the dorsal side. And this is the immediate post-op images of the same day. And that is this patient. This is a 3 months follow-up of the patient. So at 3 months, is reasonably doing his pronation, supination, his palmar flexion. His dorsiflexion is pretty good and is restricted in palmar flexion, and I think it is expected to maybe increase in next couple of months. So X-ray wise, we've achieved a decent, maybe a neutral tilt and the radial height. So I think the learning points from this are that I think not all fractures can be K-wired. However, I think it is all about the skill of an operating surgeon, because after seeing the talk of Dr. Kakatkar, he's shown wonderful results with most of the fractures, even Wohler Bartons treated with K-wires. So K-wires can be used, but of course there are limitations. Not every fracture can be treated with a K-wire. There are some cases in which we'll have a failure and loss of reduction with the K-wires. The acceptable criteria of reduction, again mentioned by the previous speakers, are very important intraoperative guides. If we follow those, if we maintain those, whatever be the modality of fixation, we'll definitely get a good result. And I agree that long-term results of plate, K-wires, or external fixators at the end of 1 year are same in most of the literature, if we see all the literature. But however, nowadays it's very important to give an immediate, better, quick recovery to the patient, because most of the patients these days, they want to get back to work as early as possible. External fixators increases the chances of developing RST. That is what the current literature also shows. The overall outcome can be improved by intervening at the right time. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mari, for an interesting case. So with this, we end up today's presentations and cases. The overall conclusion from today's presentation is that no two fractures are alike, and we can use various methods of fixation depending upon the demand of the patient and demand of the fracture anatomy, and results are almost same or equal with every technique. The matter is that how expert is the person doing the technique and how much cases he has done. So this ends with the osteoporosis month also. In this month, we have taken 5 master class on osteoporosis because 20th of October was Osteoporosis Day, and we celebrated this Osteoporosis Day with Osteoporosis Month. And our president today is not present, but on behalf of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association, President Sir, Secretary Sir, I thank all the speakers. We have involved 5 states, Gujarat, Tamil Nadu, Uttar Pradesh, Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh for all 5 webinars. And I'm thankful to President and Secretary of all the partner branches and all the faculties who have participated in this webinar and made it a very grand success. We have included 3 cases for making it more interactive and interesting discussion, and all the webinars went very well with excellent discussions, and all the faculties were with at par. So I am thankful to all the participants, all the faculties on behalf of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association. And it was also a curtain raiser for IOCON 2021 at Goa. Dr. Ram Chadda sir guided me throughout this month, and all the team of masterclass for October, Dr. Vikas Agashe sir, who was mentor for all of us, and he guided us. All the members, Dr. Abhijit Kale and Dr. Sandeep Birari, who were the coordinators with me for this webinar, all the executive committee members of MOA, organizing team of IOCON 2021, and all the states who have participated, they all guided us and helped us to make it this a grand success. With this, I thank all of you, and we conclude this osteoporosis month with this masterclass. From next month, from the 7th to the entire November, we are going to celebrate as a trauma month. So there will be 4 webinars on the trauma with interesting case discussions. Dr. Abhijit Kale is the main coordinator for this, along with myself, Dr. Sandeep Birari, Dr. Manoj Pohokar, and many more people. So I request all of you to again join for this interesting trauma series from the next month. If anybody wants to say anything, most welcome. Otherwise, we'll take it as over, and with the permission of our team, we'll conclude this session. Thank you very much for joining. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much.